Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
What about your fancy arguments?
They've got some of
those. Because there's other things.
They got some of those.
Wait, no.
Oops.
County Commissioners are now in session, and this time I want to call on Mr. Sutton for the invocation.
I want to do something a little different tonight. I asked Mr. Lyles, seeing how we have this great group of Boy Scouts here, if they will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, which I don't think we've ever done since I've been on our board. So I think it's good apropos for them to lead us tonight, if they will.
Will all please rise to pledge allegiance? I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And I would like to say, this troop is from the Macedonia Lutheran Church. And we're glad to have you with us tonight.
It's Troop 39 from Macedonia Lutheran.
Okay. Thank you. And now,
Yes, ma'am, I'll be glad to. Madam Chairman, good evening. As a follow-up to last week's meeting, the issue of revalve appraisals was discussed, and the board seemed to have a lot of questions and concerns, I guess would be the way to put it. And I thought that it would be probably a good idea tonight to maybe bring in somebody that has an expertise in this area, maybe to be able to answer any questions that y'all have about reappraisals and reevaluations, about the processes and procedures, may be able to give some suggestions to the board that may help us to move beyond where we are now at this point. So I talked to Mr. Bill Conley, and I'll tell you a little bit about him. Most of the board members are familiar with him because he served about 2 years ago. He served as an interim tax administrator for Alamance County as y'all were going through the process of trying to find a new tax administrator. Mr. Conley retired with the North Carolina Department of Revenue as the assistant director of the Property Tax Division. He was there about 32 years. A lot of what he did in his job was actually providing consultation to county commissions on their reevaluation and reappraisal process. He has dealt with at least 50 of the counties that were going through and maybe struggling with their process, was consulted with them. Some of those he went back multiple times and tried to provide them with some guidance as to how best to move forward with the process. He's also consulted, provided consultation to the North Carolina County Commissioners Association on numerous occasions there. He is actually one of y'all. He currently serves as a municipal commissioner, has formerly served as a mayor and a mayor pro tem. So he kind of understands, I think, what y'all's side of the issue is this evening. He's not here tonight to either defend the tax department or to critique it. He's really here to talk more about the processes and procedures of tax evaluation, to answer any questions that y'all may have. Y'all had a lot of very good questions last time. He may be able to help you with answering some of those. So I encourage you to redirect those questions to him again. And then he also will provide maybe some suggestions and options for the board as to, you know, some things such as maybe bringing somebody in to evaluate what has taken place in the tax office to see if things were done as they were supposed to. If not, to provide suggestions as to maybe make some improvements or whatever. So at this time, I'll call on Bill Conley, and he's available to assist y'all as y'all need him.
Okay.
Madam Chairman and Commissioners, I feel a little bit of ownership in this reappraisal because I was here about 2 years ago when you were first getting started with it. I share concerns. I have had a lot of discussions about this county from the state level and talking to Tim in the last little bit. I know what you're going through. I've been here so many times. It is not it's not a good time to be here. What you're going through this year, 27 counties started a reappraisal, the most that had ever been done in any 1 year. Since they started in the last several months, five of the counties have made the decision to pull the plug on that reappraisal for reasons satisfactory to themselves. 22 others are going forward. Many of the 22 are struggling just like you. It's I don't think it's anything specific except I think we just have a horrible economy, and I think that's driving most of them. Some of the counties have not even sent notices out for this year. They're doing it very short. They're way behind the eight ball. But you're in the unfortunate situation. The five that pulled the plug on their reappraisal did not have to do it effective this year. They had four more years. You're in the eighth year, and you don't have that luxury. And so what I'm going to try to do is take a few minutes, and I've made myself some notes, to kind of guide you through some of this if you want to listen to what I've got to say. In the 30-some years I was with revenue, we had three different downturns in the economy where just all kind of problems piled up. Counties had revaluation woes. I've been the crowds of several thousand, so what you have here, you've got hurting taxpayers, hurting taxpayers because they can't pay the bills. They've gotten values that are higher than they could sell a property for. And the least thing they're worried about is the value. I mean, they're worried about making payments to you in their taxes and to their mortgage payment. But they're hurting, and I sympathize with every one of them. But during those three downturns, it was not near to the level that it is today. Nobody knows when this thing is going to straighten out. Nobody knows when the bottom is going to be hit. And that's the reason everybody's concerned. There are lots of lost jobs. But I think you need to do several things very quickly. I think you need to get a handle on how good or how bad this real place to live. I don't think you need to do anything till you know how good or how bad it is. And I don't know. I've seen some stuff that's been furnished from the tax office, but I really think at this point you need somebody outside taking a look and saying it's good or it's bad or it, you know, it can be straightened out. And you know, it's got to be, you know, I think the biggest thing now is the confidence is not there. I've been up here many a time, and when the revaluation need to be thrown out. I've been up there when there was, you know, it just needed to be cleaned up. But I've seen a lot of times where it's confidence. The people, the public, the citizens don't have confidence in the real price. And until that is overcome, you've got a problem. You've got a problem. You're going to have to set a tax rate just a little over 3 months. And what base are you going to set it on? When I came up here 2 years ago, you know, the message I got from the board then was that your last reappraisal was not a very good one, and you wanted to get the best one possible. And I totally agreed with you and bought into doing an in-house reappraisal. Your choice was to hire it out and spend close to $2 million or do it in-house and probably have better quality and save a lot of money for your taxpayers. I went along with that, and during the 3 months I was here, did everything I could to get it going in that direction. And I hoped this was going to be the best revaluation you've ever had. I came up here in 77 and met week after week with your taxpayers. I came here in 85, the same thing. I came here in 93. I did not come in 2001. I sent staff. But, I mean, I've faced your taxpayers a lot of times over not really good appraisal work. And so I was hoping this was going to turn the corner. And I'm not saying it hasn't. I'm not saying it has at this point. But my suggestion would be to bring somebody in to look at the quality of the work before you decide what to do with it. Know what you have. Department of Revenue every year does a sales ratio study. They look at the level for different reasons. But they also look at quality. And so they can come in, independent of your staff, independent of you, and tell you what needs to be done, whether it can be cleaned up or whether you need to kind of start over. And if you have to start over, you're really, really behind the eight ball. But I would get them to do two things. I don't think you've got to the luxury of doing another reappraisal. You don't have time. You have got to give your manager a tax base in the next several months. So I think you've got two choices, to look back and look at the last one or look forward for this one. They can do a sales ratio analysis a little different than they've ever done it, but I talked to them today to see if they would be willing to do it, and they said they would, you know, honor your request. But look at the quality. What is your 2008 tax base that was a 2001 reappraisal? Is it better than the 2009? I'll let somebody else. I won't judge any of them. I'll let somebody else come in. But they can probably get that done in the next 2 or 3 weeks.
You have numbers for us.
Pardon?
You have people we can call.
Yes, yes. And like I said, they've already agreed to do it. But, you know, I think what has happened is when they appraised, I think the last number I saw, it came in about 100%. As the market has fallen, I don't know how much it's fallen. I've talked to a county this morning, and they went on last year at 99.9, and the market has fell. They're now about 101%. So they're overappraised. Their ratio is they've dropped about between 2 and 3% in value. When it goes up, that means the market has dropped. I've talked to others that have lost. My gut feel is that your market has probably dropped a little more than that. So if you're using sales all during 2007 and 2008, you probably have a reappraisal that's several percentage points higher than market value. That's causing a lot of concern. But I mean, I think just as important is a lot of the people that, you know, the value doesn't mean anything if they don't have any money to pay the taxes. But you've got to know the quality of it. But once you find out how good or how bad it is, and let's hope it's a lot better than the initial reaction, you've got to clean it up, because every reappraisal has got problems. I have never, in 32 years, I never saw what I thought was a really good reappraisal. Most of what I saw was average or way below average, and that's just unacceptable work, but that's what we've been living with. But the mistakes that's in a reappraisal were made one at a time, and they need to be corrected one at a time. You can't wave a wand and get the errors out of the system. You got, as the taxpayers openly come in and sit down and discuss their value, they can be corrected. And that's the way I would suggest doing. If you're 2 or 3% above market, the Board of Commissioners adopted schedules of values. Now you can tweak those schedules. If your goal is to, I wouldn't tweak them if the work is not consistent. But if the work is consistent and it's above market value, then I would suggest making some adjustments to some of the base rates, making some adjustments to the depreciation schedule, making some adjustments to your land values to bring it down a point or two or three, whatever is needed. I remember a number of years ago during one of these downturns in the economy, Dare County went through a reappraisal. Their land value 8 years later was still appraised higher than it was selling for. This is because the market had dropped so bad. So this is, what is happening with a downturn in the economy. It creates chaos for you dealing with it, and the tax office dealing with it, and the taxpayers dealing with it. I think if you get this report from revenue, they can tell you who's available if you need to bring outside expertise in. I doubt if you could get an appraisal firm to come in and work behind. I mean, they would be willing to, but it would be expensive. It would be very, very expensive. And I don't think you've got the time to bring people in. I think you've got some expertise on staff with your consultants, and that anything can be fixed in-house. I think the first thing you can need to do is, do you need to adjust the values downward any? And so, you know, get that report from the revenue. There are retired assessors that you might be able to call on to come in and help. But, you know, I think the first thing you got to look at is there. Another problem is, if you're still thinking in terms of delaying it a year, I would caution against that, because it would, by the time you put something else in place, it's going to be way beyond time. You already, this past year, lost 160-some thousand to the public utility companies because your level was less than 90%. And the statute gives them a chance to get tax relief at certain points in your revaluation cycle. You've lost that. Your taxpayers had to make up that tax break or tax relief to the public utility. We'll be faced with that again this year if you don't put this revaluation in place. My biggest concern is that if there's much problems, that you will not get bills in the hands of the taxpayers in time for them to be paid at par. And you don't have the authority to forgive interest. If you vote to forgive interest, a citizen could challenge that. And you would have to pay yourself, the five of you, any interest that you, returned or forgave. And so that's not an option, I wouldn't think. So one time that happened, and went to the General Assembly and got permission. But short of that, and I don't know, I can't say what the General Assembly would do, but I would not look that an option. I would say move forward, clean it up as quickly as you can, as inexpensively as you can, as fairly as you can to the taxpayers, and move on. But that 9% penalty or interest cranks up January the 6th, and that's just 9 months away, a little over 9 months. I'll be glad to answer any questions. And like I said, I'm not here to rubber stamp or anything, just try to kind of slightly guide you in a positive way.
So are we not locked in on the schedule of values?
You're locked in, but like I said, you can, if you want to open up the schedules, that would be about a 60-some day process. But there are some techniques. I think your Board of Equalization view, and I think even your assessor, can tweak these things ever so slightly, market adjustments, or call it whatever you want to where you can bring the value that, if you're at 103%, I wouldn't want to go in at 103%, or I don't know what it is now.
I don't know.
With the market today, for every three properties that are selling, probably two of them are real good sales. The other is a forced sale or bankruptcy or something like that. So you don't have near the sales happening. And so many that are happening, you have no faith in. They're not an indication of what the property is worth.
So when those were adopted, then you're basically locked in for 8 years?
You're locked in until the next reappraisal cycle. I don't believe a county has ever opened schedules back up. I know when tobacco dropped real bad 1 year, they took tobacco out of real property, and many of the counties started treating it as personal property so they could adjust the tobacco allotment and the tobacco barns and everything. But there's not much way you can do at this point. But,
adjust the appraisal.
I think you can adjust the appraisals, and the Board of Equalization view can probably have a little bit more leeway to bring it, if what you're looking at is bringing it down. And you can bring it down without hurting quality. My main concern is, being fair to every single taxpayer. And when you start making wild changes, what you do might help one but hurt two others. So you got to be very, very careful.
And certainly that's the concern of this board, is the fairness. And one of the things that we've seen is there's a lot of folks, their taxes are right, the revals. But then there's a lot of folks that they're just way out of kilter. And my question to you is, with changing software in the middle of a tax reevaluation, could that have created this problem?
It could have, but I doubt it did. I think you'll be able to tell once you start looking at the coefficients version of some of these numbers. If you check it far enough, you can see.
And see, none of us know how to we can't do that. We got to have somebody else to do that.
Like I said, Revenue has already said they would give you.
If you'll give us those names from the Department of Revenue.
Their time.
We can call them. Go ahead, Ed.
How many samplings will they pull out to look at to see if this is a good schedule or is it a bad schedule, and do they pull into effect the market as it is today?
Well, they'll probably like to have several hundred sales. You can, I've heard experts say that you could get by with as little as 25 or 30. I would not have near the confidence in a sample of 25 or 30 as I would in maybe 300.
And how do they pull these randomly? Well,
they better be pulled randomly to get a correct picture.
Yeah.
But you know, Mr. Connolly, even the sales in the last year or so is not an adequate value on homes that were sold.
I agree. This is a market. I've been in it all my life. I've never seen anything like this. My son has put his house on the market twice. He's dropped price three times. He's not had a looker in quite a while.
And that's what's concerned us is, you know, when they accepted schedule values last fall, I don't think we were in the tank where we are now.
Well, of course not. So.
It started hitting late fall, and it's just been, and nobody knows where, you know, I don't think we're near the bottom yet. I mean, I hope we are, but I can't look you in the eye and tell you we are.
Well, and what I want everybody to know, too, is that we as county commissioners cannot just throw this out. We cannot throw this rebal out. And this is what everybody wants us to do, it fix it right now. And it's really not a quick fix for this at this point. I'm a broker. Eddie's a broker. And I've been in real estate 16 years, and I know that never in my 16 years have I seen what's happening right now as well. And neither Eddie's probably – how long have you been building, Eddie?
About 20-some years.
About 20-some years, and he's a builder and a broker. So, but what the county or what a lot of people don't understand, we can't just throw it out. It's got to be fixed, and there's the whole problem here.
And fixed quickly,
and that's what, and that's what we're trying to do now, and that's why we want somebody to come in here and help us, tell us what we need to do to get it fixed.
Now, Revenue will not bring a staff and fix the problem.
Right.
They'll bring several and do the analysis, and then, you know, if you can then sit down with them, and they can tell you some individuals that if you want to bring more outsiders in, they can tell you who might be available.
Well, we have, how many appraisers do we have, Tim?
Kim will need to answer that.
Okay. We had six in-house, I think.
She's in the back room. They do a written report.
Yeah, she
they'll do, yeah. You can ask them, you can tell them what you want. What form
but,
you
I mean,
want
we have in. Appraisers that are supposed to be competent, and why can't, I mean.
They can.
That's what I don't understand. I just need to know how many we have.
Six in-house and two contracted.
I want her to tell me how many.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
Yes, that's correct. We have six appraisers on staff.
Six on staff, and you have any contracted now with you?
Our contract is wrapping up.
Okay, so you have six appraisers.
You had one full-time. You had one full-time contractor and one half part-time. Is that correct?
Our contract was one project consultant
full-time
and another one that came in periodically.
Okay. Has anybody got any questions for Mr. Connolly?
I know going backwards doesn't help that much, but there again, we've got to have another set of standards set for the next appraisal reevaluation. What would you have written differently in the standards that we approved that would have approached this situation hypothetically?
I didn't see it, so I really can't address that. But I, you know, there's no way that anybody can envision what happened to our economy, and so I don't think there's any way you could have protected yourself against it. The counties that are going through a 2009 reappraisal are asking the same questions that you guys are. It is not something I think specific to your tax office in Alamance County. It is the economy is in so much shambles. Nobody has confidence in anything. You can't buy a house because you can't get a loan. You can't, you know, it's, you know, I'm 70 years old and I've never seen anything like this. And I've been in real estate since I was 20. So.
Well, what we want to find out is there's, I heard Kim say she didn't see there was much inconsistency, but one example, Saturday night, I was at a gospel singing and I got stopped at that. And one lady lives in on Huntington Road, which are condos. And one lady went down $25,000 and her next door neighbors went up $25,000. They got the same condo. I mean, now you're going to tell, and you're going to tell me that is not an inconsistency? Absolutely, that is an. And so the woman that had the $25,000 one reduced, she said, "I'm going to go down and make them raise mine back up because it's going to affect my value of my house." I said, "You better leave well enough alone." I'm sorry, I told her that, you know, because, and that's not the only instance. Everybody here, I've had over 200 phone calls myself, emails. I brought some with me. You know, everybody here is taking bad heat because of this, and we didn't do it, you know. Now, but we are trying to fix it, so.
The sales ratio will show, it's a projection of what is out there. It's a very small sample.
I can do
but,
it.
But it's not going to find every error. You're going to have to count on your taxpayers taking advantage of the Board of Equalization review, the informal reviews, typically with a reappraisal. And this has been consistent for the 30-some years I've been down at Revenue. You're going to get about 10% of your taxpayers that'll question their value.
Right now, we're over 10.
And then you're going to have about 10% of that number that'll go on to your Board of Equalization review. And then 5 to 10% of that number will file with the Property Tax Commission in Raleigh. And those are just happen every year.
One of the things, if I may,
Madam
Chair, one of the things, and this is for you or Kim, either one, 8 years ago when we had the revals, I appealed mine at that time. I was not a commissioner. I was a chief police at the time, but the land, FERC, and they dropped it. I think it was about 5%, and I was satisfied with that. But they did it immediately. They told me right then, said, "We're going to do this." Well, why are we waiting till May to tell the folks, "Hey, instead of coming back in again, why don't we go ahead and deal with it and tell them, yes, you're right, and here's what your this is what your reval will be." Instead of having to, putting it in a box and waiting until May, why don't we just go ahead and deal with it right then? Why can't we do that? Yeah, I guess Kim, I'm asking you this.
She needs to address that.
Because we have a number of appraisers, we have 6 different appraisals, and if you remember, we want to be fair. We want to treat everybody the same way. So if one appraiser is knocking a house down or doing whatever to get the value down, then we want to make sure that's applied to all those properties in that neighborhood. And that within that neighborhood that there's some uniformity and consistency between grades, land values, depreciation, anything that affects the value. And when you've got a number of different appraisers working on appeals, one appraiser's opinion to achieve market value may differ from another appraiser's opinion on how to achieve market value. So we just want to make sure that we are being fair, uniform, and consistent in our values.
But now, these are professionals, these appraisers.
These are staff appraisers.
And you should have faith in them or they shouldn't be working here, right?
I have total 100% faith.
All right, then my question is, if it's a situation where definitely there's been a mistake made, they can correct it then, why don't we just do that?
They can. If there is a definite error, then yes, they can correct it on the spot. And in fact, I've had the opportunity to do that on a couple of occasions. Yes, sir.
Let me make a suggestion. I think there are times that what the information the taxpayer brings to you, or maybe you have on file somewhere else, is all you need to make the change to the property. In a case like that, I would suggest making it. But there's a lot of times you'll want to wait. I've seen boards of equalization review hear a case, agree with the taxpayer, and make a change. And then they kept getting cases very similar to it from the same neighborhood.
Sure.
And 2 months later, decided, I wish we had not made that change. So I think there are times that you need to do some review work And there's times you need to make the decision and change it right on the spot. But I think I think consistency at this level is even more important than the work they've been doing for the last 2 years. They can create more messes, and I don't mean to be hard on Kim, but you can create more messes during your informal review by pulling the trigger too quick. I think you've got too much invested of your time and your taxpayers, tax dollars to not finish it in a very professional manner.
Well, I was told when I did my appeal mm-hmm. that everybody's was going in a box and would be reviewed later down the road. I had proof that I have a house listed right there on the spot, and no amount was given me. Then I heard that another guy came in, and his was reduced $30,000, and it came out of his mouth, reduced on the spot, $30,000, and was told that. So there is an inconsistency there. So, and I was told that they were not supposed to tell anybody that their property would be reduced on the spot. So Kim's telling one story, and I'm hearing another one, okay? And that's my problem right now with this whole situation, is that if it can be done on the spot, let it be done on the spot. And that's exactly how I feel about it.
I feel the same way.
For everybody.
Because it's not fair. A man was in the paper the other day that his was done on the spot. Eddie got one done on the spot. On the spot. Yeah. And I don't mean to put Eddie on the spot. But Kim,
what it is.
But Kim did his on the spot. I didn't have Kim. And I brought in four, okay? And what I felt like was proof, because I am a broker and I do these, I've been doing them 16 years. And when you got a house that's listed $9,000 under what they appraised it at and you still ain't got a bite on it, just like your son, there's something wrong with that problem. There's something wrong. I think, and that's what I would love to see done, and those appraisers need to be told, if you can do it on the spot, do it on the spot. Now that's my thoughts on it, and I don't.
I think you speak for all of us.
I'm in total. Yeah, I think this board probably in total agreement on that.
With a reappraisal, you try to get everything as right as you can. During the appeal process, you have another opportunity to bring it up, to refine it, to make it a better product. And how you do it depends on the individual situation.
And if they tell us, we can't do this one on the spot, this will probably need to come before the review board, then so be it. Put it in the box. Mm-hmm. But if somebody brings in some evidence, just strong evidence, and they are like appraisers to do it, and that's what their job is, why make them do it over again? Yeah. So that's how I feel about it. And
I have no problem with
it. So that's the way I think we all think it ought to be.
Yeah,
so, and that would help solve some of this problem that we have with people calling us time after time and emailing us.
Yeah.
After this analysis is done, do we have to notify the Property Tax Commission in Raleigh of the report, or how would that work?
Well, after they do the study, they should come back either. You might accept a written report, or you might ask one or more of them to come back and tell you what they found. And at that time, if it's going to require extra help that you have on staff, then I would ask revenue to point me to where I could buy that expertise to get it as good as you
can. And you'll give us those telephone.
And so, I think they will be willing to do that. And I wish you the best, and it's not.
Well, we do also have a letter from the Attorney General that says exactly what we just talked about. Is that not right, Mr. Albright?
That's correct.
That we cannot throw it out. And this is actually from, because I've written on back of mine too, but this is actually from the Attorney General, which says we cannot throw it out. So,
another question, Madam Chair. It's kind of concluding the conversation we had at the last meeting. We talked about extending the 15 days for appeals. And, Kim, I understand that you will accept appeals past tomorrow.
Yes, sir.
Through when? So we can get it in the press.
We will not turn down any appeal until the Board of Equalization and Review adjourns.
Okay, and that's that'll be, they will adjourn June?
Probably 1st of June.
Okay.
I think that makes it the less headache you have to put the taxpayers through, to get a correction.
Yeah.
Makes more sense to me. If you can do it informally instead of the more informal Board of ENR, do it that way. I totally agree with you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Anything else? Good luck.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Conley.
Okay, at this time, we're going to go into the public comments. And I'm going to call on Mr. John Parrish. Is he in the other room?
I think he's not in the other room.
Mr. John Parrish in that room?
Parrish.
Parrish.
Parrish, I think he had to leave. He was telling me he wasn't feeling well, and he said some health issues, so he might, yeah. Yeah, yes, sir, right. Yeah, he had.
Okay, Margaret Dameron. First of all, I do want to say that we are held to 3 minutes on our public comments. You will be timed and you will hear a buzzer. And please conclude your comments at that time for everybody that is making a public comment. Thank you.
This has nothing to do with the taxes.
Bless your heart.
Thank you.
You better wait till I say what I want to first before you say that. You might want to throw me out.
Well, we got the sheriff here now.
No, that's her buddy.
Oh,
you remember that?
That's all right. Go ahead, Mark.
Did you pay her last time?
No, I should have.
Go right ahead, Hannah.
Mine has something to do with the drugs.
Okay.
Now, I don't know how you people feel, but I feel like that Terry Johnson should be given all the consideration for him having help. Anything you can do to give it on this drug deal. I'll tell you why. I had a real close friend of mine that passed on for drugs. I tried 5 years to help him get off of them. He lost 2 trucks, a car, 2 mopeds to the drug dealers. But he would never tell me where they were because he was afraid. He said they'd kill you. Well, he finally got... I think, I've always thought, and so does a couple of his neighbors, that he was killed. There was no autopsy or nothing, but I tried and tried to help him for all those years. And I know of several other people that are on drugs. And if it's anything you can do to help Terry Johnson, any support, any money, or whatever, I think we ought to take a little bit of this welfare help money and give it to him. I think we are overextending ourselves with this welfare business. Because if you're Mexican, you can go up there and get anything you want, and I know it for a fact.
Well, I worked in DSS, and it's not quite true. I worked in
social
services, too. So
some Hispanic fella that worked for a friend of mine, they turned my name in as reference. The reason why I say what I did. Her husband was making $14 an hour, and when they turned me in as a reference, they called me, and they said that her husband had left her and she had 3 children. I said, that's not true, because I picked the man up and carried him to work when his boss would call me and ask me. And I said, she said, well, where did he live? And I told her. I told her what color house it was, exactly which house. And I said, he's making $14 an hour. I said, he's bringing home a couple cases of beer every night. That's not true, she said. Said, he don't live with her. I said, well, I can do better than that if you want the proof. She hung up on me.
Well. So, I mean, I can't answer that one question there, but I do know that they are restricted as to what they get if they're not legal citizens of the United States. So,
well,
but their kids can get it, so there's the issue. So,
their children can get it.
Mm-hmm. Even as they were born in the
United States. As they were born in the United States.
I don't think she had but one that was born.
Mm-hmm. Well, that child can get help. All righty. Well, thank you.
Thank you,
Well, let me tell you one more thing. They said...
Well, I took part of your time. Go right that 1 minute. Go ahead.
They said A friend of mine's been here 30-some years. He's a Hispanic. He said that every, I don't know if he said 5 or 7 years, he has his residency renewed. And I said, well, why don't you become a citizen? He said, because I can travel back and forth to Mexico as long as I have, am not a citizen. And he said, besides of that, what I pay in taxes every year, I get it back at the end of the year. And he's a boss man in a mill.
And that may be true. I don't know all those rules. So,
I still think we're overextending ourselves with them. And they're the ones, to me, that brings in the biggest part of the drugs.
Well, I think the sheriff, I think we've helped him. He does have a task force.
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah. You need to call him and find out about that, Mark.
Thank you, Ms. Devin.
Give her your number, please, would you?
Right.
Thank you, Margaret. Pat Bailey, you may come in.
Earth to Pat.
Look, legalize.
The benefit of sitting in the other room, I found my walking stick. It's up here.
Sorry, girl.
Pat Bailey, Alamance County, all kind of ways. I have two friends with me, Nanny Lou McFain and Mildred Guthrie, and we're about Uncle Eli's quilting party. And this is a folk custom that's been going on in the county for 77 years, and last year you folks recognized it as a special event. Well, goody. This is the 78th year. What are you
going to
do about it?
This
is one of the quilts that she's been working on since September.
Look at this beautiful quilt.
It's beautiful.
It'd take me about 14 years to do that.
It'd take you 13.
Thank you.
You knew what to do.
Pat knows me.
For those who don't know, Uncle Eli's Quilting Party is down the county. It's 13 miles south of here. There's no charge. Anybody can bring a quilt for exhibit. There's no charge and no admission. The people keep coming. The ladies of the community keep working it, bringing their quilts, bringing the food. And with the help of Brian Haygood, the recreation director. By the way, Brian, we need more table and chairs this year. So, since you've now recognized it as a special event, and on the 78th year, let's name it Uncle Eli's Quilting Party Day.
All right.
Why not?
And that's what I was going to say. I'm going to hear a motion. And that is, this was done last year. It's the first Thursday in April of every year. Is that right?
This makes the 70. Even okay. The yellow pages in the phone book call from Atlanta. They said, but it changes every year.
Exactly. So it's going to be April what this year?
April 2nd.
Okay. So this year it will be April 2nd. So what I'm going to do is ask for a motion to make Uncle Eli's Quilting Party the annual event on the first Thursday of every April.
Every month would be fine, but once a year would be enough.
Yeah, once a year.
In April. Motion.
Have a motion. All in favor?
And also, for those who don't know, it's the only quilting party I know of that has a historic marker for it.
Okay.
And they also have some good food, too.
Y'all didn't vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Thank you, Pat.
Do you have any questions to ask of the ladies?
Yeah, I'd like to have one of those, but I can't make it. So. And thank you so much, Ms. McBain. I understand that you
said I couldn't speak.
But
she broke her character.
Mildred Millie, she holds national quilt titles from the 1976 on the national competition that we have here in the county. I've seen her quilts pictured in national magazines, but only a Mildred Guthrie quilt. Grandma Moses painted Grandma. And we have her here. And Nanny Lou teaches. She does. She organizes. She gets all the people to say hello, how are you, and howdy. And these three are amazing people. They're really bulldozers disguised as little women.
And that is, what time is that, Pat? 8:30 to 1, right?
Yeah, we found that to bring a covered dish, stay for lunch.
Okay.
Last year, I think it was 7 tables of food. But we found out that once they ate, they got sleepy and took the quilts and went home.
and bring a carload of friends, she says, okay?
Everybody's welcome.
Thank you, Pat. That's an Eli Whitney.
It's a good day, Sheriff. You need to go join them.
That's an Eli Whitney.
Eli Whitney is in on the phone book.
Okay.
Brian Haygood, this year we need some more chairs.
Done a good.
He's here.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, Mike Holland. Mike's probably in the back, too. Mike is going to do a presentation, and I'm not sure what it is. It's actually about at this time, and he is going to have a little longer than 3 minutes, I promise you, because he's doing a presentation. Mr. Engel, actually, Eddie.
Actually, I'd like to come speak tonight.
Mr. Boswell, I'll let you do this thing.
Put a group together, and I'll let him just take it from there.
Thank you. First of all, I'm glad to be after Pat Bailey and Ms. Guthrie and Nanny Lou rather than the tax base issue. We almost ended up doing that last week. As the director of Ceres, our organization having given birth to the several programs, including, among others, the Alamance Children's Museum, Alamance Reads Program, and the All River Trail, to name a few, I'm honored to be asked to present a presentation on the federal stimulus funding. We deserve our share here in Alamance County. I don't have to tell anybody that. We need a committee to ensure our fair share. That's the way I feel. And I'll explain why as we go along. We need to act fast, obviously, because the money's being let out as we speak. More important in the long run, I think that we need to be seen as innovators. I think Alamance County needs to be seen as leaders. And I have to tell you how important that is for economic development. If Alamance County is to be seen as an innovative county, a place to settle your new company, your division, or your headquarters, then we'll have to exhibit innovative qualities. We'll have to take risks. We'll have to create and adopt new products and services and business models. For example, we could develop a new core industry based on sustainable economic principles. This would be a phenomenal thing for our county. A committee developing a proposal for going after the stimulus funding can also become a catalyst for future innovative ideas and support the county commissioner's work. I'd like to thank Commissioner Boswell for helping us gestate the stimulus funding work group. I'd like to introduce the folks on our work group now with us tonight. If I could ask them to come up. Our Malaylee Archibald, she's the director of ACC's Small Business Center over at the Burlington Outlets. And in addition, Dave Knotts, who's the ex-director of the United Way here in Alamance County, did a phenomenal job. Also on our work group is Tom Manning, chair of the school board, Dr. Barry Weinberg, the executive vice president for ACC, Eric Henry, president of TS Design, Phil Bowers, director of Sustainable Alamance. Special thanks again to Commissioner Boswell for getting us started. And I'm going to try to use this device. I'm not sure where to point it. Scott? We're here today, the Stimulus Funding Work Group, to request of the Alamance County Commissioners that a Stimulus Plan Committee, an official committee, be formed to develop a proposal to go after an equitable share of the federal stimulus funding. The question is, why a committee? At the current time, and we found this out through the process, there is an existing request in through the county for $10 million put in January by the assistant county manager. And right now I'd like to quickly look at how that compares with the local municipalities. Burlington has already put in a request, as you're probably aware, for about $21 million, $12 million of that. Almost half of it is going toward two upgrades. And I was talking to a reporter in the hallway here, and he said he felt that that money was not going to be stimulating, not stimulative. It was not a part of a stimulus program. It was part of filling budget shortfalls and paying for programs that were already in the works and had to be done anyway. Burlington is already said to be receiving $28 million for just two road upgrades. How does this affect the rest of the county, the unincorporated areas? I'll let you decide that. Graham has requested $6.5 million for water, $9.5 million for sewer. Those other programs in the 21 million for Burlington, by the way, were all infrastructure for the most part. So you can see, if you compare the population of Burlington, about 50,000, with that of the county, 150,000, an equitable request at the county's part would be around $63 million compared to Burlington's request. So it appears that an addendum to our existing request could be called for. An example of a type of proposal that could be added as an addendum is, this is just an example, I've put this together and I've run it by our funding work group, but we certainly are not proposing this, we're just showing this. Weatherization, as you know, is a key priority for directing the funding. There is a possibility of putting together a robust program that could put in 1,500 jobs, new education-based, training-based jobs in our county, upgrading the attic insulation in all 50,000 Alamance County dwellings for a minimum cost of $62 million. This matches well with the equitable request that the county could be making if we're in par with Burlington's request. And I'm not suggesting that we'll be detracting from their request. It's an additional request. So this gives us an equitable request. And in addition, it directly affects each and every one of your constituents. So it's a direct stimulus proposal. The benefits of a committee. So the county has requested $10 million. One way to use the committee to our advantage is to go back with an addendum and broaden the request to include job force development, as I said. The Green Roofs example would be competitive because it would have a strong full committee of citizens using good public relations. It would be a direct request of the governor's office through Dempsey Benton. It would have ongoing communications with Raleigh, all the things that are lacking right now. Few counties, in addition, are going after the funding. I should point out that Craven County, the home county of Governor Perdue, and I think I've sent a YouTube video around to each of you. I hope you've had a chance to view it. And several people had backed out. They asked me to re-edit their positions out. And as you saw, they were fairly substantial titles in that movie. It was shot at the Emerging Issues Forum, the Governor's Forum, back in February. In particular, a North Carolina trustee from NC State said in his county, in Craven County, the commissioners are going directly to the governor's office. So there is a county-based, commissioner-driven request for funding going on out there, in particular that county. We have an opportunity for increasing our request through a committee and reacting in addition to the news that's come out since this process has started. And it gives us a chance, if a new round of funding comes through, to be prepared, ready to go with a committee to react to that as that money is made available. Let's see. Now, in regards to that proposal that I mentioned, the more important key point here is the weatherization of our county, weatherization being a key outlay of money this week across the country, up in Massachusetts, down in Georgia, here in North Carolina in particular. Hundreds of million dollars have been already allocated for weatherization projects. So going back now with hindsight and increasing our request through an addendum and using weatherization as a key is a valid way to go about this. It would allow us to partner with our cities, to go into Burlington and say, and here's an example, Graham's request of $6.5 million for water was only paid out, and they've received news on this, at $180,000. So you can see the disparity of what they're asking and what they're getting. And being able to be more competitive partnering with the county could help them with their requests as well. It's not a competitive situation with our cities. It would help reduce our carbon footprint. We would use less energy as a county. We would be prepared better for brownouts, situations where facilities fell offline, where electricity was at a premium in the summer. Our county would be using less energy. It would show leadership. It would help drive education into each house if we had a home energy audit, an auditor helping with the weatherization program. So each constituent could be working now with the planning office directly and benefiting by increasing the efficiency of their homes. It would reduce the energy bills of your constituents immediately. Money for local economy would be a direct, for local spending, would be a direct outcome of reduced energy bills. People would save money the very moment that the house was upgraded. And finally, it would make us seem from the outside, just by forming the committee, as a forward-looking community, an innovative and visionary community. We wouldn't look like many other communities across the country are simply trying to use the stimulus funding to stave off shortfalls in their local budgets. And so finally, the downside. There is no downside. If we ask, we can only be turned down. Nobody's going to punish us for asking for more. We're basically saying more, please, going from 10 million to 60 to 100, whatever it takes, whatever's possible. The upside is that even if turned down for the money, we will have formed a stimulus committee, and that committee could then, its purpose is over, could evolve into a sort of local forum. A sustainable business forum is an example. A forum that would then support the needs of each of the commissioners as you go into issues of a sustainable economic future. The forum could put together a sustainable economic master plan for the county. These are the things that could come out of this committee turned into a forum. We've been offered a chance to house this at the ACC Small Business Center. I'm very glad to have some support from the president of the, the vice president of the school, and also from the director of the Small Business Center. Alamance County can be seen as an innovative place to grow your business. And I think that asking for the committee is the essence of my presentation tonight. I'd like to thank the commissioners, each of you. Your county staff, the IT people here are phenomenal. I think they should get raises. They had some bumps tonight, but it's normally nothing like that. I'd like to thank the fellow citizens that are here in attendance for your patience with this long public comment section. I can get my daughter home now. She's in the other room. And the members of our work group, in particular, for taking their time, these local business leaders and politicians and educators, to come out and help be innovative and be leaders. And finally, my wife and my daughter, Chandler. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. So are you asking us to do this committee tonight? Is that what you are wanting us to do?
I wouldn't surprise you with that. And I know you've had some time to look at the video. It's not self-explanatory other than to say there's not a lot of information out there about the counties.
Right.
We don't have a lot of competition.
Yeah, because I don't think we're ready to do this tonight. So, but we will...
And I wanted to thank Commissioner Boswell for being our liaison, and I would like to offer, we need to have bipartisan support for this. We'd like to offer a commissioner. I talked to Commissioner Engel about possibly being our liaison from the Republican side as well, so that offer is available.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Thank you.
Okay. The next we're going to have Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly presentation. This is Barbara Garrison. That's all of the public comments. I'm sorry, I have to close the public comments first. So the public comments are now closed. Now I let you go.
Madam Chairman, board members, and ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the opportunity to address you on behalf of the Alamance Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly. We are grateful for the county's support in matching existing funds for aging services. We hope to encourage you to increase the current county funding for these vital services. Our county continues to see a growing need for services and supports among our elderly county residents and their caregivers. As the chairperson of this committee, I want to remind you that our voting members are appointed by you and report to you. The Planning Committee was created to determine the need for services for Alamance County's older adults and educate the public about those needs. Identify gaps in long-term care and community-based services for seniors, and identify resources and opportunities to fill those gaps. It was created to involve the county communities in planning and implementing options and opportunities for seniors, which will foster the independence of adults 60 plus living in the community and in facilities. And last, it was created to make recommendations about home and community care block grant service funding, which is in your packages as Form DOA 731. To go on to some statistics and demographics about North Carolina and Alamance County. You may not be aware of some of these. 28% of North Carolina counties have more adults over age 60 than people under age 18. 13% of Alamance County's residents are 65-plus. 12% of North Carolina's residents are 65-plus. By 2030, Alamance County's 65-plus population will increase 70% to 31,371 people, or 17% of the county population. By 2030, North Carolina's 65-plus population will increase 106% to 2,178,062 people, or 18% of the state population. Also enclosed in your package, you will find the North Carolina Roadmap for Healthy Aging 2008 and Alamance County's latest demographics for aging. To continue, we're talking about now Alamance County Planning Committee's activity in 2008 and 2009 so far. The Planning Committee developed and is in the process of implementing a strategic four-year plan for aging services in Alamance County. Top three needs were identified. Number one, information and access to aging services. Number two, caregiver and respite options. Number three, transportation for seniors. The top three strengths identified were number one, family-based support and care, the faith community assistance through our churches, and number three, cooperation of key resource agencies. The Planning Committee has raised awareness about national trends and issues affecting Alamance County, or Alamance County's aging population, including digital TV transition, Medicare open enrollment dates, the impact of the current economic crisis on local seniors and aging with their service providers, and senior scams and frauds. Alamance County's 60-plus population is growing at an unprecedented rate. It is of the utmost importance that you, the Alamance County Commissioners, remain aware of the needs of our county seniors and use your elected positions to make wise decisions that will help our communities meet those needs. In closing, I thank you again for the opportunity to address you this evening. Speaking on behalf of the Alamance County Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly, we appreciate your time and attention. We also appreciate the Honorable Ann Vaughn's dedicated attendance at our monthly meetings and her valuable contributions to our efforts to plan strategically for the county's elderly adults. The last item in your package is a list of the participants in your Planning Committee for Aging, both voting members and non-voting members. Ms. Willie Mae Curran, Alamance County's delegate to the North Carolina Senior Tar Heel Legislature, and who is also vice chairman, she's a Planning Committee member and extreme advocate for our county's older adults, would also like to share just a few items regarding adults 60 and better in Alamance County. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Ms. Curran, how are you tonight?
I'm fine. I'm just fine, and I want to speak loud enough so everyone can hear us. I want to be heard because we are so proud of what is happening in Alamance County. When I go to the senior legislature and speak to them, I always say, first among the 100 counties alphabetically in North Carolina is the county of Alamance.
That's right.
And if you don't believe it, that we are first in many other things, come on down and see, and you will be very impressed. And we have such wonderful people who work with us, not only in the Alamance County Planning Committee, and I'm speaking from the heart now, but also the senior legislature. We have two people that I want you to meet. We have Catherine Sutherland, and we have Blair Percival. They are adorable people. They work with us, and they make us feel so important, and they give us the information that we need. I have been a resident of Alamance County for 53 years, living at 211 Bank Street. I taught in school here for 26 years, and when I retired in 1978, I was immediately asked to be in numerous activities regarding seniors, and I was delighted because I'm an 86-year-old, and I'm working for myself. Now, we have so many organizations here that are so great that we are so proud of, and let me say to you, thank you for appointing us. Thank you for supporting us. Not only this present Board of County Commissioners, but those in the past have done so many wonderful things. And I want to talk about some of the things that you have done because we're so proud of them. When I was chairman of the Planning Committee, we had community forums all over this county. We met everywhere, and we asked the citizens, what are your greatest needs? And they told us what they were. And you responded to them. When the hospital was changed, or when the county hospital was closed, we understood it was going to be sold. There were all kinds of activities going along about selling it. We wrote resolutions saying it should become a human services center because seniors had said, we need a 911 number that we can access all of these programs all over the county instead of running around in an automobile and looking through the talking telephone book to find the numbers of the people that we need to access. You did that, and we were tickled to death. Look what it is today and what it is doing. But you know, so many of the organizations moved out of the buildings down on Martin Street and went to the hospital that they were left vacant. We wrote a resolution asking that they should be reserved for people who, for organizations that were paying high rent elsewhere when that money could be used for services to the elderly. At first, we were told it wasn't going to be done. I don't mind telling you, a previous county manager way back, and we remember, said, I'm going to sell them if I have to sell them at less than tax value. Well, he got a response from us, and it wasn't very nice. I won't tell you what we said. But we got those buildings, and for $1 a year, and volunteers went in and renovated those buildings, and they are beautiful facilities. Now, within one block, we didn't have to have a 911 number. We pulled the agencies together where people could accommodate them. And when you were talking about transportation, look at ACTA. ACTA, the Community Services Agency, and the Friendship Center, which is a daycare center and a health care center for the elderly, are all contained in one of those buildings. And when the Agricultural Department had to move from Elm Street down into that building, they moved there and saved the county a lot of money without having to build another facility for them. And they not only are working for the agricultural people, but they're working for youth. The 4-H Club people are there. And I was the 4-H Club member from age 10 until I graduated from college and then went into the Extension Service. And I love it. And I'm still a member of the Honor 4-H Club. I love it. And the 4-H Club has meant so much to me because it says to make the best better and pledging head, heart, hand, and health to do it. And we still are doing that. The virtues from that are so much. Now, ACTA was formed, and look what a beautiful, listen, you just can't imagine how wonderful we feel that they are because they respond so beautifully to all of our needs. And then, according to the 911 number, we said you don't need a number. We developed elder care. And your chairman is standing right back here, Brenda Porter. And she's one of my former students, and I've got a lot of us in here. And we are so proud of them. They've done beautiful jobs. They are meaningful in this county. They love the people. They access services for them. And they don't stand around idle. They do beautiful things for us. We have so many wonderful agencies. We have agencies that are catering to people who can't be in institutions. They are Forever Young, or Home Forever, your Angels Aware, your agency.
Yeah, Jean is here. Angels at Work.
Angels.
Touch my angel.
Stand up, touch my angel. When you get 86, you don't get everything.
Yeah, this is Jean, this is Jean Crisco, and I'm going to tell you, she's my sister-in-law, okay?
That's wonderful. And we have so many, and Belle says one of my former students.
Yeah, she didn't answer that.
I have a number of former students here, and one of my former students now is the alternate to the North Carolina Senior Tar Heel Legislature with me. And in the 16 years that I've been in that program, I've only had an alternate that was active for 3 years until George came along, and he is enamored by the people in the Senior Tar Heel Legislature in Raleigh. They love him and they adore him. And we are just so proud. We have the, and another thing, the public agencies have worked with us. The police department started Are You Okay programs, commuter programs, where people could call in. We have a wonderful hospital that has the Lifeline program and all of the other services that are so valuable. And we worked for seniors right here in this county, and many of the needs in this county have been negated into law in the state of North Carolina and are being copied nationally by other states. And we do things for people. Just let me tell you a little bit of what we do. When the paving company came out here and stayed for 5 hours at the home of an 89-year-old lady and wanted to pave her driveway to the extent of $2,000, she called us immediately and said, "That's all the money I have." Immediately, we found out that check had been cashed. We called the Attorney General. We have a direct line to the Attorney General. David Kirkman works with us, and she got her money back. We got her money back, and she was so delighted. We work for people, and we work for organizations, and we don't want people persecuted by bandits and other people that are taking place. The sheriff does a beautiful job. All of these checks that are being sent to seniors, we've worked with them and we've taken care of those. And I'll give you one example. A lady at Hall River called me and she had gotten a $2,000 check and she asked her husband not to cash it. She did not find out that he had cashed it. He was in the intensive care at Alamance Regional Medical Center until he was in the intensive care there and she found out he had cashed that check. And they had sent her a letter charging her 20% of that $2,000 as a penalty for not having paid it. We took care of that right quickly, too. The Attorney General got a copy of that check, and she got her money back. And she, before she got seven other checks, though, and the Attorney General had all seven of them. And I asked to call them and ask them to take her name off the list in New York. And the gentleman in New York that answered the question says, "Are you a member of that family?" I said, "No, we are not a member of that. I'm not a member of that family. But I am interested in what she's doing. Well, give me your Medicare number and your Social Security number, and I'll see what I can do about it." I said, "You're not dealing with an idiot. You're dealing with people who have common sense and who are intellectual, and we will not have it." And I said, "Your name is before the Attorney General, and he's looking into this. We got that taken care of." I'm just saying we don't sit idly when you appoint us. Thank you for doing that. You are just so great. And now, I've been on that committee since 1990, and we're working very hard. Then in 1993, the Area Agency on Aging asked me if I would serve as the delegate from Alamance County to the North Carolina Senior Tar Heel Legislature. And I said, "Yes, if I can be the head, if I can be on the Crimes, Security, and Safety Committee." And I had reasons for saying that. I won't tell you what they are because I don't want anybody to get in trouble. But we have done so many things that are so interesting in that. And tomorrow we will be going to Raleigh to the senior legislature for the 16th year, but we will be having our 15th year celebration in the governor's mansion. Governor Perdue has invited us. She's the one that initiated the legislation for the senior legislature. And we highly regard her and respect her because she is interested in seniors. You've done so much to help us. You have made senior life interesting. You have inspired us to reach out to the seniors in this county. And we are going to continue to do so. As a result of wanting to be on the Crime, Security, and Safety Committee, I introduced as the first, we don't make laws, we propose legislation. I proposed the criminal background law for every person who works in any facility for the elderly. It took us 13 years to get it done, but it's a law. And it's being copied by other states and it's gone nationally. We've done so many things that I think you would be interested in. The no-call program. You know how when you sat down to the meal at night, you had all these calls coming in telling you what you wanted to do, and it, we got the no-call program instituted. When we had people call us and tell us how much they owed on the payday lending program, we got avid about that, and we did something about the payday lending. And the CAPDA program was repealed by the assembly.
Thank you guys for coming. That's all right. Thank you for coming.
You're a wonderful group of young men. We need you. You're going to be seniors one day, so listen. When the CAPDA program, the Community Alternative Program for Disabled Adults who could stay in their homes and get help, was repealed. Now, we were furious about that because you can't put everybody in a nursing home. We got that program reinstated, the list extended, the number of people eligible increased, and you couldn't take one, and you could put one in if somebody died or became too well to stay. Now, we have new resolutions, and I have, don't tell me I didn't bring that up here. Yes, you have the bulletin. We are Region G. And I'm telling you, no region in North Carolina is in more favor than we are with beautiful people like Donna and Catherine and all of the other people who are on that. We do think we're advocates for the elderly. Now, they don't call us politicians. I don't hear party mentioned. We are people and issue-oriented. And so we just work hard as everything. And the five resolutions that we are submitting to the General Assembly are to provide funding to sustain Project K. And we have good people here. We have new people, that new organizations that are coming up. And I'll give you this brochure that's just been organized. We look for services for seniors to provide those. And we want an increase in funding for home and community-based services for older adults by increasing the home and community care block grant by $5 million. We have about $860,000 that we fund in the planning committee, and we budget that money, and we monitor it every month to see that it is being used, and we look at the waiting list for people who are there. We don't just pass it out and forget it. We work hard to see that it is used. But we need additional money because we are very aware of the economic times and what is happening to seniors on fixed incomes. And we've got to do something about it. I visit in a nursing home every day where my husband is presently a patient. And I go up and down the halls and speak to all of them. And I know some of the needs, and they are so grateful for the attention that they get, and I love them devotedly. Then we've got to, we want to increase funding for senior centers. What would we do without the senior center in Burlington? Just go there and see what's happening 7 days a week. And this one is one that has been, now we have one every time from Alamance County on these five, and this is one that we proposed. Implement practical and cost-effective steps to address concerns related to the mixing of populations, including young people with mental illness and frail older persons residing in long-term care facilities. And look at the episode we had in Alamance County, right up in a family care home, where a 25-year-old man mentally ill with a criminal record was placed in a home with four 80-some-year-old women, and he killed one of them, stabbed to death. Now, we're not going to have that. And the state heard all about it, and this is being looked at. We work hard. And then another thing we want to do that's a little bit of an issue right now was proposed by a former officer of the county commissioners in the state. Establish a cap on the increase in the assessed value of property determined during revaluations for persons over the age of 65 eligible for the homestead tax exemption. They paid taxes all of their lives, some of them on the property that they're doing, and the property ought not to be raised in taxes when they're on income and below the poverty level or below the level to seek help on the homestead tax exemption. And there are two bills in the General Assembly we'll be talking about, one. One of them is House Bill 423, and we're going to be investigating that and look at it. And I hope you look at it and that you propose favorably for it. And the other is raising the homestead exception tax that is now $25,000 to $30,000. And the cost of living index also goes in that. Thank you for letting us serve people. Thank you for letting us represent ourselves. We are not going to sit still. We are going to do what we want to do. We admire you. We know that you have many problems, and we know that this economic situation is going to hit you hard. You have our prayers and our blessings. But make the best better.
Thank you.
Ms. Curran. You make your question. Ms. Curran. Could you elaborate briefly on House Bill 423, please?
I will ask
George.
I want you to know George. He's a former student of mine, and everybody in Raleigh loves him. George, would you
stay? It's just raising the income level to $30,000. Plus, it's going back in. Carrie Allred has introduced this bill. It's going back in and changing some of the technical aspects of the bill, accounting semantics that were, I haven't found out who slipped these in, but they were slipped in middle of last year, which ends up denying a lot of senior citizens the right to qualify for this homestead exemption deal. And it's just, we're better than this. I don't know how it got in, but the state of North Carolina is better than what's happened. And House Bill 423, it deserves to be supported by everybody in the state of North Carolina. Hopefully, maybe a majority of the legislature will reverse what they did last summer. We can only hope and get behind it and support it. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Now, we have some of the members of the Planning Committee who are charter members. And there stands a gentleman from Elon who is just a very special person and revered on this committee. And we love you. You're from Elon.
Thank you.
Who else is on our committee? Would you raise your hand, please? We ask them. We have quite a few who are here. Some of them are voting and some are non-voting. But we work hard, and believe us when we say we don't come to you frivolously asking for things. We have studied them. We expect you to listen to us and to give us the respect that you have given us the jurisdiction to do in these committees. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And next on our agenda is Drug Enforcement Administration presentation by Wally Cherniak, resident agent, U.S. Department of Justice. How are you?
Good evening. Mind if I take my jacket
off? No, not at all. Don't pull your gun on us.
It's getting warm.
I think we all want to be interested in this.
I appreciate the opportunity to speak before the commission. Thanks to Sherry Johnson. What I'm going to talk to you tonight about is the drug threat in Alamance County. It is a very serious, severe problem, something that should not be overlooked. I'll give you just a very brief rundown. As of fairly recently, within the last 10 to 15 years, the Mexican national drug trafficking organizations have really taken foothold in the domestic U.S. Up until that point, the Colombians basically oversaw the production and the distribution of cocaine, predominantly cocaine, in the domestic U.S. Recently, and I say recently, within 10 to 15 years, Colombians has seen the opportunity or seized the opportunity to utilize the Mexican drug or the Mexican organizations in Mexico to transport and smuggle the cocaine and marijuana into the U.S. They've been smuggling, you know, humans forever. So what they have done, what they did was to get the loads of cocaine into Mexico, sell it off, and they're done. Mexicans since then have really taken the transportation to a completely different level. These organizations run very similar to the Fortune 500 company. You can see a host of similarities, I won't go through them all. They are very highly structured. They're compartmentalized, and they're compartmentalized for a reason. Your transporters, your smugglers, your couriers don't know who is the source of the cocaine, where actually it came from, or where it was stashed, and that's all done to really protect the load. The load is the money. What we see here in Alamance County is a major, major hub, a major transshipment point for narcotics, mainly cocaine and marijuana, for the East Coast and the Northeast Coast. The Gulf Cartel is probably their biggest source in Mexico. These loads are smuggled across the border. We call them piggybacked. They usually get piggybacked anywhere from loads of 5 to 50 kilos at a time. They're amassed, again, over the border and either brought up in tractor trailers or trapped out vehicles. What we've seen recently is that they're back to using the SUVs or vehicles with multiple traps because we've been fairly successful intercepting these larger loads, and obviously they lose those loads, so they'll just piggyback loads up smaller quantities. We've seen, I don't know if the sheriff's going to speak about it, I want to take his thunder, but we've seen a rise in heroin overdoses and deaths. I think
we've had 29 deaths, not all drug related, but 9 of them appears to be drug related, and I think 5 are heroin overdoses.
Brown.
Since December 1st.
Brown heroin.
Yeah. Well, I don't know.
Looks like
probably.
Black tar and brown heroin.
Brown comes out of Mexico.
Right.
White comes out of Asia.
Right. Well, Colombia, actually. Yeah. And that's one of the things that's really kind of that's puzzled me. We don't see a lot of Colombian heroin here. Predominantly the brown heroin or the black tar heroin, which is Mexican. But there's been an increase of heroin overdoses, and that is directly attributed to the increase in use of the youth with the pills, with the prescription. They've got hooked on these prescription medications, and which have become very costly. I mean, $30-$40 for a pill, they can get a deck of heroin for $10. There's a number of cases that we've worked, the DA's worked together with Alamance County, and I'll just kind of blow through these kind of quickly. I guess the point here is that, again, I said this is a major transshipment hub for the Mexican drug trafficking organizations. It's not destined for here, all of it. Some of it is. A lot of it's destined for... A couple slides back, you saw Chicago, New York, Philly, D.C., and up the Northeast Corridor. But what we have seen is that, I was asked earlier, the reason Alamance County in particular, this area in general, is a major hub, but particularly in Alamance County is our hotbed. I mean, this is where we see... And we've made the largest seizures in my area of responsibility. I cover 21 counties, from Charlotte up to Virginia, out to Iredell County, and then Alamance being the furthest east. This is by far the most significant county for a drug movement. And the reason for that, it's multiple reasons, but there's major thoroughfares that go through Alamance County. With that, it's very rural. The drug traffickers like that the rural areas where they can stash their loads. I mean, some of these loads come in tractor trailers. They need a place. You're not gonna bring a tractor trailer in Walmart, and it will float it there. So they'll bring it to the rural areas that have these big barns, these farms, trailer parks. Yet it's very accessible, through these major thoroughfares. And then just geographically where you were located, where we're located here. It's a direct pipeline from Mexico, whether it goes into Texas, whether it goes into California, whether it goes to Arizona, they pipe it across and it goes right up. Traditionally, or in the more recent past, Atlanta has been or was, and still is to a degree, a major hub. The same organizations in Mexico have these cell heads, we call them cell heads, in say Alamance County and in Atlanta. So they'll send a load to Atlanta, and they'll send a load up to Alamance County, and they'll go back and forth depending on law enforcement activity, and then they'll adjust. And we know that based on some of the things that we've been doing. Bulk movement of money. Again, Alamance County is a main focal point for the collection of the drug proceeds. One method of which is to bulk carry it back to Mexico. Obviously, that's very bulky, so they'll utilize vehicles and tractor trails to bulk carry the money back down to the border. They'll also use money remitters. They'll wash their money through businesses, properties, other assets. This is just a picture of some of the firearms that we seized with Alamance County in one of the investigations. We're seeing a major, major increase in drug-related violence. Economy is a reason. The cartel wars in Mexico is another reason. That's probably the biggest reason. Recently, we've noticed that there's been a shortage of narcotics in the domestic U.S. and here. Reason for that was because the Mexican cartels have been at war for quite a period of time, and they are literally killing each other. They're killing each other for control of the drug trade. Now, recently, there's been some meetings between the cartels, and they're kind of trying to work it out because coke and marijuana is money. If they don't get it here, it's worth nothing there. A kilo in Mexico is, less than $1,000. Here, now, it's 30. Last year, a little over a year ago, we were seeing the cost of a kilo of cocaine was about $17,000 wholesale. That's wholesale. That's Mexican to Mexican. Now, you break that down in the street, you're talking about a much more significant amount of money. Now, Mexican to Mexican, you're talking about $30,000 for that same kilo. So the poor knucklehead here who's got the 1 kilo, nobody wants to pay that much for when it's broken down. So he cuts it up. They're ripping people off. You got home invasions, you got shootings, you got rips, it's gone berserk. And it's directly related to the wars in the cartel wars in Mexico. This is just another example of one of the cases that we did where this drug trafficking organization was laundering their money through this auto place. An investigation here. This is a 3-year investigation that we did, started before I got here, and this is some of the stats just to show you. This is one drug trafficking organization. This is what they've moved. We seized 300 kilos of coke. We seized over $3 million cash here in Alamance County. The numbers are staggering, and we're only getting a small percentage of what's coming through here. Understand that. Residences, vehicles, firearms. Again, I think traditionally the Mexican nationals were not a violent transportation crew. They were not. We didn't used to see guns with drugs. Now we do. They have to arm themselves because they're going to get ripped off. It's a domino effect. This is a little more recently. This is actually an interdiction that came to here. All roads lead to Alamance. Stuff comes here. I was in Atlanta last week, and I got a phone call. I'm jumping ahead of myself, but I have ADHD, so
we
I got a phone call from Oklahoma City.
And
the supervisor of Oklahoma City said that Oklahoma City State Highway Patrol interdicted 39 kilos of coke destined for Alamance County. He's given me the particulars on the stop, and the transporter, the driver was cooperating, and I knew immediately. I knew where it was going and who it was going to. Alan Bailey, the CFO in my office, had opened an investigation, and I just knew based on the particulars. And I said to him, I know who that's going to. Well, long story short, it comes here, we deliver it, and it goes to exactly where we thought it was going to. Now, this is just an interdiction stop. We didn't have any informants, we didn't have any intelligence, human intelligence, or electronic intelligence to tell us anything about this load. But here it comes, right to Alamance County. Again, this is September 08. Another interdiction stop ends up here in Alamance County, 20 kilos. This is the money we had seized from this location on a case that we did last year, and we got $147,000, almost $148,000 in a trailer. Actually, if you look to the left, you'll see that's the particle board that's. As we're knocking on the door, they're trying to dig it to dump it down. This is another investigation that we did back in 2008. You can read, you look at stats. I mean, you know, one case, 29 arrests, 29 guilty pleas. It's a beautiful thing. We got them good, right? 50 keys, 170 grand, yada, yada, yada. Guns. Never used to see that before. This is the one I spoke about earlier. That we just wrapped up February 21. It's pretty recent, right? We've been able to tie money seizures throughout the country to Alamance County and the drug trafficking organizations that exist here in Alamance County. I won't say how we know, but we know. Okay. Just look at this. I mean, 1.85 million cash was seized, right? That came from Alamance County. A known DTO here. We call it Drug Trafficking Organization, DTO, that we were working on here. And you'll see here, the next is 3 million. It's mind-boggling.
Wow.
This is just... kind of get your attention if you're kind of falling off here a little bit. This is a seizure in Mexico. Okay, look at that. 400 firearms, 500,000 rounds of ammo, grenades, vests. These guys are better armed, better protected than we are.
It's scary.
These guys go and train. They train with terrorists. There are organizations, there are drug trafficking organizations in Colombia, the FARC, all right, and the AUC, that have been deemed terrorist organizations. They are funded by drugs. This is a good one. This is just an example. Look at this. Almost 6,300 murders in Mexico in 2008. That's 1 year. That's 1 year. All because of drugs. They've been killing judges, prosecutors, federales, any law enforcement in Mexico. It's unbelievable. 800 Mexican police officers were murdered in two years. Nobody ever saw this before. Drugs is money. It's here. Alamance County, if you can talk to a Border Patrol, a CBP, in Texas or California, and they have license readers, they see the vehicles, it comes back to Alamance County, they're like, wow. I mean, Alamance County is, for a lot of different reasons, but it's a major, major hub. I've been here for 2.5 years. I've always worked with the Colombians. and I'm now seeing the significance of the Mexican national drug trafficking organizations in the U.S., and particularly here in this area. I mean, Alamance, Randolph, and Guilford are probably our business areas, but Alamance County by far is where the who's who in the drug traffickers are. Again, I appreciate the opportunity. I welcome questions.
I'm sorry. The 29 arrests in Operation Rain Man, and then the 63 arrest that occurred in Operation Mad Cow. How many were illegal immigrants?
Majority of them. I don't have the actual numbers, but I would, off the top of my head, a very, very, at least 80, 90%, probably higher, conservatively.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Good.
What do you do with the drugs and the money? Where does it go?
Money? Mm-hmm. Goes back to you guys.
Distributed back.
We have a federal forfeiture.
So is that what he gets back in?
Well, what happens is when there's a seizure and we're involved with it, or even if we're not involved with it, mm-hmm. there is a federal forfeiture proceeding, and it goes back 80% of the asset, whether it's cash, real property, whatever, can be what we call dagged out. And then it goes back to the state and local agency that was involved in that case where the seizure took place. Here's something that kind of blows my mind. DEA doesn't get any money. We take 20% for administrative. We don't get the money. If we kept any percentage of the money that we seize, we would be self-sufficient.
Oh, okay.
We, DEA, seizes 70% of all assets in the U.S. Everybody else, every other federal agency does 30%. We do 70. Drugs is money.
So it's the same thing with guns as well. That's the same scenario, that if they seize guns, then that goes back. You sell them or something, don't you?
No. We'll destroy them. Guns. We destroy guns, and the drugs are destroyed.
Just the drug, okay.
And the whole process
and the
we
drugs
go through.
Are destroyed.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll just keep representative sample, but the rest is destroyed.
Okay.
I saw other night on the news they had they were talking about how the cartel is actually coming into the United States and hiring teenagers as hitmen. Has that been something you noticed in our
Zetas? The Zetas are the enforcers for the Mexican drug cartels, and they are here. They are here. We've arrested a few. You have your SUR 13, your gangs.
It was scary. I mean, just watching this for 13, 14-year-old children,
right.
They're hiring at $500 a week retainers and paying them $50,000 a hit to kill people.
Hey, you're talking about a culture that for them to think about doing that, think about what it must be like to live in Mexico.
Right.
So, I mean, it's tough to deal with.
Is the federal government, I think I heard them say that the administration is considering sending National Guard to help out on the Border Patrol. Is that something that you foresee?
Should it be done? Yeah. You'd literally have to build, a wall of walls. It's too vast. Right. It's just way too vast.
It's confusing to me, though. I mean, here we are on the East Coast. Why is that a central spot going north?
Why is here?
It ends up, I mean,
look at the road infrastructure. For that reason only. I mean, they are, the drug cartels, the transporters, the organizations are, they've been, Miami at one point was the place to traffic through. Again, once the Colombians turn the transportation over to the Mexicans, they just get it to Mexico. They can get it via the East Pac, the Eastern Pacific. They can get it through the Western Caribbean. They can just drive it up through Central America. And it'll get there. We have assets, but not enough. I mean, the East Pac, they'll go around the Galapagos Islands. with what they call refuelers, because they know the Navy, they know what their limitations are for fuel. So they have refuelers, they call them, the drug traffickers. Certain miles out, they got a refueler. Vessel goes out, refuels, keeps on going, goes around the Galapagos Islands, runs in Mexico.
Very sophisticated.
Very.
What's the name of the city where they've announced that they're having just a record number of kidnappings in the United States? Is it not Phoenix, is it?
May have been.
Is it Phoenix?
That's in Mexico. That's Mexico.
Juarez, Mexico.
Well, no, they're talking about in the United States.
In the United States.
It was in Laredo and stuff.
Arizona, I believe.
Phoenix, yeah.
Phoenix is another major transshipment hub for the movement of narcotics.
Because it comes straight up. I've been to Nogales, so that's probably one
it's
of the...
It's wide open there.
Yeah.
It's just wide open.
Yeah, because you could just walk across.
We have agents on the border. It's bag and tag. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know.
I'd like to ask a question, if I'm right, and I'm not sure you want to answer it on camera. We apparently have some well-known drug dealers or drug kingpins here in Alamance County. What is the relationship between all the trafficking that's going on and our king here in Alamance County?
You're right, I can't answer that on camera. I can tell you this. My philosophy, and this is my philosophy, we have done, are doing, and will continue to do a lot of things you will never hear about for a reason. Okay, and I'll leave it at that. But we have a very good idea who's who. It's a matter of proving
public knowledge.
We have to get the evidence. We have to get a case. You know, the whole nine yards. Yes. So we have a very good idea. I should have brought the stats. I mean, I think my office alone last year, the year before last, sees $9 million. $9 million for one office. You know, we're hurting them, we're pissing them off. We haven't stopped it, and we'll continue.
Years ago, before we got into 287G, we contacted the Salt Lake City, Utah Police Department. And they were going to be the pilot program for 287G. And they had a police chief there by the name of Ortega Tino, and they were going to their city council claiming that 80% of their street-level drug sales was tied to illegal immigration. Okay, and long story short, they didn't do the pilot program there, and they put out these quick response offices. And I think North Carolina got Charlotte. Charlotte was already there, but Winston-Salem and Raleigh. And then we got into 287G. Can you tell us what percentage that you feel is tied to this issue, number one, distribution and sales? And can you even begin to speculate on what this county would be like if we had never gotten into 287G or if we hadn't have partnered with ICE? We've still got a problem in doing that. How bad would it be if we hadn't ever done that, possibly?
How bad would what be the...
The trafficking, the...
Has no effect on the trafficking. I mean, 287G has no effect on the trafficking. It may be where you're going to pick up somebody that is a trafficker, but, you know, these guys, I mean, the DTOs and the members of the DTOs here, all right, it's like a family business. You know, their dad, their grandfather, probably back then they were moving marijuana. You know, we've seen in the short period of time that I've been here, we've seen the generational takeover of these drug traffickers. Now, a lot of them have been naturalized. They're born here. So they're not illegal. I don't believe that, you know, the 287G affects that. I mean, my understanding, I mean, if somebody's picked up, we may get one. You know, we don't use that to target anybody. We don't. We have other methods. So I don't know if I can really answer that.
Well, I would think we wouldn't be as easy a target than if we were a sanctuary county. You know, it's your job, you know, I'm just a layperson here that sits here, but you know, I would think a sanctuary county would be an easier place for it to be centered than somewhere where it's where it's obvious that we've got our ears perked and we're watching, unless they just don't care about being arrested and being deported, knowing that they're going to come right back because we're not enforcing the laws.
That happens all too often. Yeah. I mean, and not all the individuals that are affected by 287G are drug traffickers.
Right.
So, you know.
So they're not worried about immigration laws, period, I wouldn't think.
Not worried about them. Obviously not. I mean, you know, they get back here. I mean, how many times? I mean, I can't tell you how many times we've arrested, a subject and he's been deported and he's back. I mean, look at how easy to get a license. Now, that's not just here in North Carolina. That's anywhere USA. You know, what do you need?
Any more questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Cunningham. Very informative. Thank you so much. Okay, the next on our agenda is Farmland Preservation Ordinance Amendment by Mr. Doug Fincannon. How are you?
Fine. Thank you, Madam Chairman, Commissioners, for the opportunity to be before you this evening. I have two items I'd like to bring to your attention. The first is a proposed change to the Alamance County Farmland Preservation Ordinance. As you all know, that in 2007, the Commission established this to promote the preservation of farmland in Alamance County. And if I might just say, we're very proud of that ordinance. If you were to go today to the North Carolina Department of Agricultural website and look at farmland preservation, our plan is the model. It's right there on their website. We're the first county to have one. We're the standard that the other counties are looking to. And so you are to be commended for what the commission has done for preserving farmland here in Alamance County. And we appreciate what you've done. As you know, what the plan, among other things that it does, is it allows a landowner who owns the property himself to make a determination as to whether or not he wants to put that land into permanent preservation as farm or forest land. And there are other aspects that come into play in that. He can donate part of it. It can actually be purchased by state, local, and federal monies teamed together, a combination of those two things. But our goal as a voluntary ag district board with this ordinance is to try and cluster as much permanently preserved farmland and forest lands in the southern third and the northern third of the county. And we've started with your support to doing that and making good progress, and we're very appreciative of that. Owner of land determines that he wants to put a permanent easement on that property, the county needs to be in a position to hold that easement. There may be others that can do that, private organizations, but the county is one means of doing that. And with that in mind, we have a need to amend the ordinance to make it effective going forward. And we're really trying to do two things. First of all, the current ordinance allows for the consideration of an opt-out after 30 years. A farmer puts it into preservation, and in 30 years after that, there is the possibility for opting out of that preservation easement. The proposed change that is before you this evening is to eliminate that provision and make the easement in perpetuity. Why are we proposing that? Really, it is being requested and required of us by the state and federal government. First of all, if you do that and monies come with it, there is a requirement by the state that this ordinance be in perpetuity and not have an opt-out to it. So if we're going to take the money that you all have funded for preserving this farmland and try and put it together with a match from the state or the federals, the state is going to require this to be done or they will not allow their money to come forward. The second issue is that if a farmer chooses or a landowner chooses to donate his land, there are tax credits, federal and state tax credits, that are available to him or her for doing that. And this must be in the ordinance if they're going to qualify for that tax credit. And these two things are very essential to the success of this ordinance. And so we would ask that this great ordinance that you all have put in place that is the model for the state be amended so that we can continue to keep it effective going forward.
Discussion on this? Am I got any questions?
I don't have any question. I think it's a great idea.
Okay. So do I hear a motion?
Move.
Have a motion? And all in favor?
Okay, thank you all very much. I just have one other quick matter, if I may. On behalf of the Voluntary Ag District Board, I'd like to thank you for the attention that you have paid to this issue of reval and assessments are going forward. It is our responsibility to be your eyes and ears among the farm community. We've done that. We've had two public meetings. We've obviously meet in, with the farmers as they come to the county office, ag office building over there. We've had a lot of input. And one of the things that we are able to tell them is that we know that they have your ear. And tonight was just another example of that. So we thank you for that. The Voluntary Ag District Board did meet last month. And we had three proposals that we have passed unanimously, having interacted with the farm community that we'd like to give to you. And I'll just give those to you briefly. First of all, we would just request, as an idea, to help through the business personal property listing form that is mailed out to the farm community, that it be accompanied with an instructional sheet, a brief handout, maybe a small manual, that will facilitate better compliance in listing the farm business personal property. There's a lot of confusion out there. Part of that is just it may be previous tax assessors years ago may do something one way. There is a legitimate interpretation that can be made among tax assessors, and it may be done differently. We think that if it was codified in our tax office, we know that would be a lot of work. It's not something that's going to be done immediately, but if it could be done, it would be a great assistance to the citizens here to understand how they are to list their properties. There's a lot of confusion about that, and I think you'll find that anxiety bubbling up, that, and that would be a great help. The second thing that I would put is that we would just ask that you would maybe direct the tax department to, and they are doing a good job in this, to instruct to continue to educate the farm community on the appeal process. We heard this evening that that is going to be extended and it's still available. We do appreciate the fact that the tax department, Kim and her staff, came to two public meetings for the farm community. They have been accessible. We would just want to continue to encourage that. We're appreciative of that. There is still a lot of need out there and anxiety among the farm community. You know as well, it is hard times. Many poultry farmers have lost their contracts for raising chickens. They don't have the ability to produce income, but they've got all of this burden upon them, and now we're adding one more thing. So there is a lot of anxiety on that. So if there could be just continued publication, a lot of communication as to how they can go and appeal the their assessments, and if there are back taxes that are going to be assessed or penalties because they have not purposefully but negligently improperly listed taxes, many of them feel the weight of that. They're concerned about that. As long as they understand the appeal process and what they can do to mitigate that, we would appreciate that very much. And then finally, we understand the burdens that are upon you. There are many things that are pulling your way, but we, in light of the current economic conditions, we would encourage you on behalf of the farm community as best you can to keep a revenue-neutral tax rate going forward. And again, we appreciate your response to our community, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.
Next is Sheriff Johnson, who is here to talk about repairs to the
pension. Yes, ma'am. I'd like to ask the commissioner tonight, we'll be showing some of the things that are going to be going on, but we've had a problem since I've been in office for 7 years of inmates in the old jail upstairs over the administrative offices stopping up the commodes and flushing them, and the water and whatever else comes with it goes into pipe chases and comes down onto some of our secretary's desk, our computer rooms, and my desk. And I'd just like to show you a few of those things. As you can see, the real dark spot there. That is in the off color. I won't call it chandelier, but glass that covers the windows.
Yeah.
And here's where the ceiling finally fell out, and you can find where we're catching it in the bucket. And right there, your computer room is over on this side, which if it gets in there, and we've stopped it a couple times, we're going to lose millions of dollars worth of servers and things. As you can see, there's the computer room. You can see some spots on the ceiling where we were able to catch it sooner than later. Right here, and we're putting up ceiling tiles probably, I'd say, three times a month in the ceilings, which is becoming very costly to us. And we've been very lucky in keeping it off of the right there, and you can see the different colorations in the glass there, which is the lighting, and you can see over in the corner there. And of course, you can see the yellow stains on the vents, which come through vents. And here's the fire alarm system and water sprinkler system. And we've asked Surface Concepts, they gave us a bid to do all of them, and it was $41,457.15. But then we had our maintenance people to go up and go into each area where it was coming down and try to save us as much money as they possibly could. And they said that if we could get 44 of the pipe chases done, and that's installing a liquid seal urethane membrane to all the pipe chases and the floors, would cost us $19,827. And we've probably done put up that many pieces of Celotex since I've been sheriff. And what I'm asking on this is to allow us to do that once we have exceeded our $6 million revenue that we said would bring in from the old jail, anything over to use for these repairs. And I'm asking for the commissioners to allow us to do it. If not, you know, two, it's probably going to cost us a whole lot more money if it ever gets into the servers in our computer room.
How close are you to that?
To
the $6 million.
I'll have to ask Amy. Some of the checks have not come in. You know, the feds don't pay good.
Wally. Yeah, it's in the mail.
I think he'll make it, Miss Massey. Right now we're at like 4.2 that we've collected. We've got a few more months to collect, so.
You didn't show anything of these pipes. Now, is that something that, I mean...
I don't think you want to say what it is.
I'm sure if you said this bid from Surface Concepts came in, how many bids did come in?
Do what now?
How many bids did come in?
This is the only one we got because they had done the jail floors previously in the old jail. We can go out bids, but I'm gonna be honest with the commissioners on something. Right now, if we can use local contractors in Alamance County, I think our tax money needs to go to our local contractor.
Thank you. You're right.
And that's, you know, but we'll do within the law what we're supposed to do on this.
Okay. Any more discussion on this?
We'll check to make sure I'm bringing it at that dollar level. We're not going to have to.
I don't think you have to.
No, no, that's level. You just mentioned bid, and I'm wondering.
I'm saying we'll.
Motion.
Discussion for. Is there any more discussion, Mr. Sheriff?
No.
I'll entertain a motion at this time to approve bid.
Motion.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed. Okay.
Okay, I got the next one.
There you go. Let me know. We'll do everything else.
Yeah, at this time, I'm going to ask Tim Camadis to come in and make this next presentation involving computers in our car.
We wondered what that was.
Yeah. And
we're not expected to learn all this tonight, are we? You don't expect us to learn this tonight. I just want to make sure here. Are we going to be running this anyway?
We will also be asking that money's what is needed to do this come from over our $6 million, too. A lot's already been put in this year's MIS budget, which Tim will inform you on.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
You said this would be over the $6
million. Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm here tonight to speak about MCTs, or mobile computing terminals. Basically, we're just talking about computers and cars. They will allow us to communicate with CECOM and other vehicles and certainly make our jobs more efficient. We purchased an MCT software, the module, when we purchased the OSSI platform. We're currently running the RMS, JMS, and the CAD. And that part has already been purchased. All we got to do is turn it on. Features of mobile computing. One of the biggest features is silent dispatch. Silent dispatch allows communication between dispatch and patrol directly through the mobile computer without the use of a radio. Calls are dispatched through the computer. Deputies can respond with a single press of a button. This reduces radio transmissions on the main channel, and which is very full. Instead of radio transmissions, deputies can communicate to CECOM and other deputies with the MCT that they are on scene, en route, in service, beginning or ending their shift, or in danger and needing immediate help. All again with the press of a button. They communicate any of those with just one button. Those can be programmed. When CECOM dispatches a call, a computer-generated voice instructs deputies of the call for service, reducing the need to look at the computer screen while driving. This certainly allows them to hear the call. It's basically called text-to-speech. It allows them to hear the call without having to look away from the road, which is even probably a little bit more than they get to do right now, come with radio a little bit. Certainly not a danger, but it does help. Deputies in distress can press a single button that alerts CECOM and other deputies of their exact location. This feature enhances officer safety by allowing them to immediately respond to the situation at hand without the need for radio traffic. If you pull up to somebody and you have a situation and you need immediate help, the last thing you want to do is play on the radio. You don't want to have to wait for traffic to let up, call CECOM, wait for them to respond, and let them know what your problem is and where your location is. You hit a single button, they have all that information, you can handle the task at hand, and I think that's very important, certainly for officer safety and for community safety. All right, talking about AVL on the mobile computing, another feature. AVL, known as Automatic Vehicle Location, uses GPS to give CECOM the ability to see the exact location of patrol cars via a map on their CAD console. CECOM can dispatch the closest available car to a call, ensuring the quickest response time. And again, this doesn't matter which car is in which district. You know, we have districts in the county, and we have a car in each district, along with some floating cars. All that matters is the closest car, and that allows CECOM to dispatch that one so they can get there the quickest, which, of course, I'm sure is important to everybody. On traffic stops, AVL will automatically alert CECOM and all other deputies the location of the patrol car making the stop. This enhances officer safety. And an officer can, it's just like I mentioned with the officer needs assistance, the officer can quickly address the car without delay, the delay of having to wait for the radio, call in the tag, call in the license and all that. They can just hit that button and enter they can enter the tag and they can get right out there and address the person in the car. Certainly not allow them to think or do anything more than, you know, prepare for that deputy to come up there, which is an officer safety as well. CECOM dispatches a call to deputies. AVL shows a map on the deputy's MCT on the computer that displays real-time car location and destination. This feature will assist deputies with call locations and improve response time. I know when I was on the road, I'm a city boy, and I'm not real familiar with the county. And certainly when a call came in, it was very difficult for me to find. I'd have to call CECOM, get cross streets, all very time-consuming, takes up a lot of radio traffic. This pops a map up automatically. You see where you're at. You see the location. You find it a lot quicker, certainly increasing efficiency. NCIC currently, deputies would have to radio CECOM for any inquiries on running license plates and driver's license. This takes up a ton amount. I would want to ask Dexter how much time this takes up on the radio. This would free up a large amount of that, except for detectives and a few other units maybe running some radio traffic. These officers, these deputies can run this completely in their car.
which is certainly a big help. And the addition of DCI with the mobile computers allows deputies to query the NCDMV licensing and registration information directly through their computer. Basically just what I said. OCA numbers, which are report numbers, and time of call are already on the MCT, reducing radio traffic and errors in communications, which, you know, we've had both. Same thing. If you get a call, you got to write a report, you got to call CCOM, get a time of call, and get the OCA number. You know, it's just more radio traffic. When dispatched to a location, deputies can see all previous calls to that address on their mobile computer, enhancing officer safety. Of course, if we've had calls out before because there's weapons, if they have gun permits, if they have concealed carry permits, we can see that on the computer. We can't now. We don't know. If they have violent conditions, if they've had domestics out there before, we know that going in. And we know that before we knock on the door, and it certainly changes how we approach it. Deputies can also see images of subjects and buildings and layouts of structures on the mobile computer. Certainly a big help. You have someone barricaded in a home. It's nice. Obviously, we got to work with maybe the tax department or somebody, the planning, to be able to get some of those layouts. But it would definitely come in handy for officer safety. Deputies can add notes to CAD record from the mobile computer that can be later be viewed in RMS. And right now, it has to be communicated to CCOM. CCOM enters it. It'd be nice to bypass the middleman and be able to do it yourself. When information is entered into the MCT, into the mobile computer about a vehicle or subject, it searches all available databases for information. Talking about our local RMS, our local JMS, also DCI, which is NCIC, and it also searches P2P, which we currently use right now. It's an information share that anybody who's hooked on OSSI, just you basically get a look right into their database. And it's nice because sometimes they're in neighboring counties, and most of our neighboring counties also use that. It alerts deputies to active warrants, prior weapons, violations, gang affiliations, and other information for officer safety. This is a good feature. Active BOLOs are stored on the MCT for viewing at a press of a button. You know, these BOLOs come out sometimes several a day, and it's hard to remember certain details about that BOLO. You have a lot of deputies calling back. What was the color of that car? What was the location? What were the specifics? You can just bring it up with the press of a button. It's right there in front of you anytime you need to. If you see a car matching that description or a person, you have that at your fingertips. Also, all previous calls for service can be queried directly from the mobile computer. Also a great benefit. I called many of these agencies. I know we have several deputies who worked at some of these agencies, and they could confirm. There wasn't anywhere that I called that wasn't already using computers in the cars. And you look at some of these smaller agencies, you got Gibsonville, Hall River, Elon PD. Somebody told me today, I didn't even bother calling Caswell. Caswell also uses computers in the cars, Caswell County. Obviously, some of the bigger ones, Guilford County, Greensboro PD, Chapel Hill, you would expect that. But we are certainly, I think, a little behind. I didn't call a single place that said we don't use them. I didn't omit anybody. Everybody I called said they use their computers, and they love them. Talking about costs, laptops that will be used in the cars, the docking stations, and the network server, which we have to run a VPN on to be able to access the network and do the communication. Those are already in this year's, our current budget year's MIS budget. And I have confirmed with them that money is there for us. The non-recurring cost this year, this current budget year, to complete this project would be $55,600. Recurring costs for 2009-2010 have already been submitted in the budget. And the annual recurring costs after that, of course, you know, inflation, everything's getting us, but it would be estimated at a little over $30,000. Obviously, air cards, DCI terminals, NCIC terminals, all this, you know, it would be an ongoing cost, estimated over $30,000.
OSSI rental be including that too?
OSSI is already in our budget. It's already part of that. It would exceed that. That doesn't count.
That'll be in every car?
That would be every patrol car, our street crimes and...
Our street crimes, patrol cars.
Yeah, main patrol cars, absolutely.
Our detectives and vice, and then vice might have one or two, but other than that, just the patrol vehicles and your street crimes, your ICE.
That's all I have.
Isn't it true that we already have some computers in some of those cars?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
We have some we've gotten on grants.
We purchased those.
I mean, it may sound like, well, we didn't have any computers in any of the vehicles, but everybody else does, even Caswell County.
Yes, ma'am. We do have some.
I have a problem.
The places I called have it in either all their cars, or they have a current plan to put them in all their cars. They will be completed no later than 1 year. So we don't have that. And also, our computers are outdated. Most of our computers are running Windows 2000.
They are when you buy them.
Yeah, which is why we're not buying these computers. They are leased. And
what's the difference between leasing them and buying them? See, the figures we had or received, there's a lot of zeros in there.
Yes, ma'am.
And I'm not comfortable.
Yes, ma'am.
Unless we get full disclosure. That's really what I'm saying. I want full disclosure.
Absolutely. And when I put zero, for instance, the air cards, we have to have air cards for communication.
Right.
And it's the best form we have out there. There's no cost to purchase the air cards, so I put zero. There is a monthly cost, so that's where the majority of the recurring cost comes from. Some of the things, there's an initial purchase cost, but there is no recurring cost. So that's the only reason there's zeros, either when there's not an original purchase cost and there is a recurring cost or vice versa.
Is the quality of this system comparable to Guilford and Randolph?
Yes, sir. It absolutely is. Burlington just went live with a very similar hardware setup, and they're using the exact same software setup, and they don't know how they got along without it, people I talked to.
Which Windows are you going to use? What Windows will you use, XP or Vista?
We'll probably use XP. I'll definitely take some lead from MIS on that.
Vista, I hadn't tried that one yet.
Yeah, I think we're still accustoming to Vista a little bit, and I'm trying to learn lower the learning curve for some of these deputies also. So I would probably use XP.
Just use XP.
I got a question with the air cards. I know you said you already have computers in use across the county.
Yes, sir.
Do you have the reception across the county for these computers? I mean, I know there are a lot of.
I've rode the entire county three
times.
Whatever
you want to call them.
Yes, sir. I've rode the entire county three times. Verizon certainly seems to give us very good coverage. All of them were very comparable. But I didn't lose signal one time in the whole county. Sometimes it dropped down to
I've had a Verizon. That's why I ask where I live. I don't have reception.
Cars, the other thing about air cars, too, is they will also jump off other towers, so you can share towers.
I hate to have cell phones. A patrolman counting on this as an operational thing, and
absolutely.
And you don't have it because it's not there.
That would have been a deal breaker for us. If I would have rode the county and, 20% of it, I wouldn't have got connection. I wouldn't have really seen a huge reason to spend the money for it. But it would benefit us greatly. If you also look, too, there's some air card external antennas, which I put in the purchase. Of course, no recurring cost, so that would be zero. But these will boost the signal, strengthen the signal a good bit. Yes, sir.
Well, with OSSI in the cars, they do the reports right there, sitting right in the cars.
In a way, we did not purchase the module mobile field reporting at this time because we want to go ahead and get off the ground with the computers. So until we purchase that module, they wouldn't be able to do that portion of it. But there is so much they can do, it certainly would benefit.
Yeah. Is there an additional cost, say you get a new car and re-upfitting to a car?
Totally have to pay to switch it out to the new car.
But you can take it and transfer it over.
Yes,
and I don't think it'll be very costly. Everything's bolt-on. Everything's bolt-on. Yeah, probably no more than $300.
Do you think in the future that we can get the figures for what would be coming out of the MIS budget and what is coming out of the Sheriff's Department budget? It's not clear.
You want to know how much is coming out of MIS's budget?
Yeah.
Because that's the only number that's really missing from here. And I don't necessarily have them, but I can get that for you, absolutely.
Okay, and then another question. In the very first paragraph on the cover.
Yes, ma'am.
Last sentence, cost does not include mobile field reporting. Well,
that's exactly.
I feel like, the sheriff's going to want that. What is the cost?
I don't have numbers. It's costly, or we would have included it in the first one. That's something we definitely want to go to one day. This is everything
I've... too soon, and yes, possibly could do it with federal drug seized assets or...
Okay, stimulus money or whatever.
Sure.
With the 800 megahertz that we should be getting along about October, I think you said, are we not jumping the gun with this? In other words, OSSI, from everything I've done some research or trying to figure it out, is software.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely right.
How would that go with the 800 megahertz? Is that a conflict? I mean, is it going to gel? I think any system we get is going to take time to work out the bugs or kinks or whatever you want to call it.
Sure.
Is that going to be a problem? And should we do this now or should we wait? What I would like to ask is you put this in the 2010 budget.
Well, we put it in the upcoming budget, the reoccurring cost. What we were asking, that I think it's $55,600.
Yeah.
To go on and once we've gone over to 6 million and fix our floors and get these in the cars. The 800 megahertz system will have nothing to do.
It's unrelated.
It's unrelated to the computer terminals in the car.
And there's no GPS in the 800 megahertz?
Do I need?
There's no GPS system and so forth with the 800 megahertz?
I don't know of a GPS. I'm not real familiar with 800, but I don't know of any I don't know of a GPS unit. And if there was, it would work in a totally different way for us. I don't know that it would work with. I haven't heard that it would work with CAD as far as vehicle location, which is what the main reason we're using this for.
Our technical folks are saying no.
They're shaking their head.
800 megahertz is just another way of communicating signal.
Yeah.
You know, the computers in the car will be able to use 800 megahertz, be able to use the air cards, or even a local Wi-Fi if they're in Graham or something like that, as long as they give us permission to do so.
I was just wondering about any duplicating of information or it's not services I want, what's the word I want? Do we have any duplication going on between the 800 megahertz radios?
I don't know of any. I don't believe so.
No. Frank.
Absolutely. It's just a different communication method. Yeah. This system will be able to do any three or four different ways of communicating, and the software residing on the notebook will keep the session persistent, is the way that they term it. You write out of one area, you run it and pick up another cell, it keeps your session alive from one tower to the next. It's all a pretty slick system, and the only reason not to do it is money, of course. There are lots of good reasons to do it, and like I said, most of the localities around here are already doing it. We had already budgeted for the hardware and the software on the MIS and the notebook in this year's budget. And I think what he's asking for is some of the other software that we didn't put in our budget.
So you've already budgeted for the 55,000?
Well, the 42 notebooks.
The 3886 is budgeted.
He's also saying, I'm sorry to interrupt you, I apologize. He's also saying that last year when we did the budget request, MIS put money in for this project because we assumed that we would be going with it this year. So they put money in for the computers, the laptops, the docking stations, and the server.
That was approved in the budget.
Right, and that is already in this current budget year's budget. That's why it wouldn't have to be added to next year's budget. It's already in there right now, ready to be spent.
All right, the computers.
Yes, ma'am.
The Burlington Police Department was the last police department that I know of to go to semi-automatic weapons. You know, we're the last law enforcement agency that I've seen that doesn't have computers in the car. So I make the move that we motion that we go with this plan.
I'll second that. That P2P is really nice. It's helped me clear a lot of cases.
That's something P2P. They would have access to, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Is any other? So this is going to come from the excess money from the $6 million.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay.
He's got to go over to 6 million.
We don't get it, we have to wait.
Okay. So if you don't go over, you're not going to go.
Or use federal assets or where we can get it.
Right.
That's what I just was money. You're not asking for it from general fund.
No, ma'am.
Okay.
I am not.
Okay. I just want to clarify that so everybody knows. This is not coming from our general fund. It's coming from the sheriff's money.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a motion.
Please make some more money.
I have a motion.
Go get those drugs.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Likewise. Okay. All right. Did you?
Thank y'all very, very much.
Did you? No, I'm for it because it came out of his funds and.
Okay.
Otherwise, I would have asked for it.
I've lost my agenda here. Hold on. Okay. The next thing is there she is. Social Services. How are you?
I'm going to follow the sheriff's tone here, and I'm going to ask you, I have before you a contract for Automation Solution for Social Services. This, I think you have the numbers in front of you. This will come out of the DSS budget as well, so we're not asking for an appropriation out of the general fund. I bring some more, hopefully, good news that the County Commissioners Association predicts that you'll have about a half a million dollars in refunds from Medicaid this year.
All right.
So I'll just tag that on to the end.
Is this what we talked about before?
Yes, it is. This is a part of our program improvement plan related to our Medicaid compliance and timely processing of Medicaid applications. I have with me the folks from Northwood, Mike Drayback and Gary Heinze from Ohio. Have Frank Merrick's here, who's met with Northwoods and done a site visit, and I think we're up and ready to go. And I also have Stuart Keeler, who can talk about the piggyback exception for the contract, all in line with Orange County. There are 10 counties online with Northwoods, and we expect great things in terms of being able to absorb the current demand that we're seeing for social services systems.
Okay. Any questions?
Did you ever get a quote from Randolph County?
Yes, sir, I did.
What was their figure?
Randolph uses LaserFish and Serenade, two different software programs. They've spent a little over $400,000 on their solution, and that does not count. Theirs was a home-based IT program, so they said I could add a zero to that, and that's about their investment. But they did it with their county IT, and theirs is a countywide solution. But we've priced out some, and we're actually coming in under on some of the equipment from where they were.
Any more questions?
Is there an annual upgrade to this every year?
The upgrades are included.
And that is. I was just noticing in the purchase agreement on number 5, it said effective from so-and-so 09 to 20-something.
There is an annual maintenance.
There's an annual maintenance fee that will be on the system.
That's right, okay. And we've included that in our next year's budget. Okay. And we still had a decrease.
Okay.
Good.
Okay, I'm entertaining a motion.
Okay, I sure will. And Clyde has worked on the contract with the folks at Northwoods, and
I beat him up real good for
him. good man, Clyde. You're a good man.
Okay, at this point, I'll entertain a motion.
Second.
Okay, all in favor say aye.
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 Nah.
All opposed?
No.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, the next thing we have is to make an appointment for the Alamance Community College Board of Trustees,
that was interesting.
We have several applications on here. Has everybody read the?
Yeah, read that.
How many positions are we appointing?
Hey, I think
two.
Just
two.
It's two vacancies.
Just one.
One in there.
It's just one for us.
I read that they want us to.
Yeah, somebody else has the other one.
Alamance Borough School System.
School System. Okay. Yeah, we only have one that we can appoint out of all of these that we have. So.
You ready?
Well, I've read them all.
I've got someone, Madam Chair, that is interested, that is not in our list, that is very, very well qualified, that I'm going to nominate. He was a county commissioner for 2 years. He is an alumna from Alamance Community College. His wife has also attended several functions at Alamance Community College, and he will be an outstanding person to be on the board, be someone that we can work with very well. He is pro-education, and he'll be also a positive asset in terms of working with the commissioner. And his name is Doug Fincannon.
Okay. I'll second. I didn't see anything on him in our packet, and I was interested in the Joe Barber credentials with all that Joe's done for our community, and he's been on this board as well. And Mayor Burlington, but that's a tough decision between Joe and Doug, but I'll support that. I'll second that.
Can I ask why he did not apply?
He probably didn't know he had to be honest with you. And he had contacted me about 10 days ago with an interest, and I didn't tell him to come up here because, quite frankly, I didn't know we had to apply for this position. Normally, we just, you know, we make recommendations, and we decide as a board, and if it's, I don't know that it's mandatory that they apply, we can nominate anybody.
Okay. All right. I have a motion on Mr. Fincannon and a second. Any more discussion? I'll call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No. Okay. It's passed with four.
Only because he didn't apply, as the rest of them matters.
Okay. Okay. The next thing is Mr. Scott Ward. The master.
The webmaster. That's right.
Good evening, Commissioners.
Good evening.
Madam Chairman, I am here today to introduce you to the new county website.
Okay.
Just for a brief history, the county website began in 1999. We launched sort of an early version, and in 2001 we launched our first official website. In December 2004, we launched our second version. This is the version we have been on for 4.5 years now. It is an enterprise-level content management system. What that means is that MIS personnel, we manage the layout, we handle some of the policy enforcement, that kind of thing, but we leave the data that goes out on the site up to the departments, because we feel that somebody from, say, social services or the health department knows things for social services or health better than we do. It also means that it's designed for an organization much like Alamance County. In 2007, we began to look at the update to the software that was being provided, and the research showed that there were going to be some pretty significant costs involved. I spoke with some people in the private sector who have spent hundreds of thousands of dollars to upgrade to the new version of this software, so we began to look at other options. Late last year, we settled on a product. We began to look around and selected a company from South Carolina. We did look, talk to a couple of local vendors. The only one that got back in touch with us to any significant degree got back in touch with us after the due date for their bid. So, the costs, of course, this is an issue in this kind of economy. This year's costs for our new website, currently, the last time I checked, our licensing costs have been running about $19,000 a year. I may be a little off there. That's just for the licensing, and that's a yearly cost. That is the government price. This particular product, if you were going to go in the corporate sector, it would run closer to about $26,500 a year. There were some indications that the government price was going to go over $30,000. So this is, and to make it worse, it's a complex product, which means we're talking training costs. Our new product, in comparison, this year's costs, that's budget year 2008-2009, we're talking $26,000. Next year's costs, $6,000. The year after that, $6,000. This includes the library's website. They are also being upgraded. 3-year costs, including this year, the current system, over the course of 3 years, would cost approximately $57,000. Over the course of 3 years, the new system will cost approximately $38,000. Savings about $19,000 over 3 years. Now, I realize that's not a lot in the county budget of many millions of dollars, but this is, you know, this is what we can offer. Okay, we're going to take a look at our current sites. We're going to take a look at the new sites. I'm going to demonstrate a few of the new features. In fact, Thomas caught me with one of the features back there, and I'll talk a little bit about that. Please keep in mind, we are still building this website. So I'm going to take us on our adventure here. First, we're going to take a look at the current library website. Now, this is the website we've been using, that they've been using since 2001. This was our, kind of based off that 2001 website that we did. And this is our current website. It's a little bit better, a little bit, you know, still kind of messy. Looks like it was designed by a big fat geek in MIS. This is our new website. I've got, let me get back over here. Got about Alamance County. This is actually the Civil War Memorial, one of the things that, come on, mouse. Need to get a hold of them MIS people there. This is our new website. This is the homepage. The homepage we're looking at, it's actually missing a couple of things. We're working on a calendar right now that will contain all the Board of Commissioners meetings, all the planning board meetings, all of the recreation board meetings. We're going to try to get all of those on there. We're going to try to make it very active and up to date. Of course, you see last week's commissioners meeting, all 182 minutes of it are available directly on the homepage.
We're working on it, Scott.
Let's see. We're here with the county commissioners, so let's go take a look at the county commissioners' website. And well, there we go. There's the county commissioners. I can pull up some of those. We've got our meetings. This actually the same concept with our current site. Our MIS people are working on the back end stuff. We're letting the departments handle this. I know she hates for me to point her out, but Pat Jones has been working on the commissioner's website for several years now, and she's worked very hard on getting this up to date. So this is what we have. But of course, we don't just have the commissioner's website. I'm gonna pick a little bit here on Environmental Health, who's just built a phenomenal website, and they are not the only ones. We see they've got a great website with lots of information. Our About Alamance County, we've copied a lot of the same old information, but we've updated some information. We've got more information on Alamance County history, for instance. That's a personal project of mine. Of course, we have our Alamance County video. We've got a couple of other features. You may have seen the AC blogs. We're going to look at using those as a way for government to communicate to the public. They won't necessarily be two-way communication, but it'll be a little bit more open way to communicate. Speaking of such things, I'm going to head down here to recreation, and the reason I'm going to head here is because Thomas caught me. He caught me tapping on my BlackBerry and asked me, "Scott, are you Twittering?" Why, yes. Yes, I am. Twitter, for those of you who don't know, is a way that people can update information very quickly with very short little remarks. It's very popular among various, groups of political action groups and that kind of things. But governments are also using them. And one of the ways we're using them, for instance, Recreation has used theirs in January when we had the ice storm that came around, or the snowstorm that came around. They sent out a Twitter. And, of course, the kids get the notes, and the kids know what this is, and they were able to be updated on their ball games and practices being canceled. And they knew before their parents ever did. So, yeah. So we've got a lot of features, and like I said, we're also updating the library website. I want to introduce you to the new library website. It's very much updated. They've got these nice little pictures here flashing through, and of course we can click on these pictures and get nice big previews of librarians in action. So we have really. We're very excited about this. Again, we are still building. There are some things that are not out there yet. Our goal date for launch is April 3rd. We may or may not make that depending on the company we're dealing with. They're still dealing with some issues. And when I say we, I don't just mean me. There is a team of 80 county employees that are putting the data out there, and what has been built already has been done in a month and a half.
Good deal.
They have been working hard to get it done, and I'm very, very proud of each and every one of them. I'd also, I'd like to thank them publicly. I'd also like to thank our website committee. We've got a committee internally that helps develop the policy and the layouts, and they've worked very hard. And finally, I would like to thank county leadership. Mr. Burgess helped out greatly. He's also on the committee. Mr. Albright here has helped us out with some policy issues, and of course, Mr. Merrick's my supervisor. They have all been invaluable to me. So, are there any questions? Yeah.
Good job, Scott.
We don't know anything to ask.
You didn't. You didn't show the sheriff. Sheriff, do you Twitter?
He's Twitter. Yeah,
I don't have one.
Twitter bird.
Twitch.
Is that what?
I'm being recorded.
He just throws his hands up. Yes, you are being recorded.
Well, it's all right.
I can use my BlackBerry or, say, a cell phone, and I can type in a message, and it updates automatically on the website within moments. And so it's very useful for recreation. One of the other things we're looking at, David Leonard and I have talked about using Twitter to potentially handle, say, emergency situations, where, you know, if he is on site, you know, let's say, a disaster occurs, you know, the Hall River floods, and he needs to, I know, it's shocking, and he needs to say, you know, the bridge over the Hall River on Highway 70 is closed. He can be on site and say, okay, it's too dangerous, boom, boom, it's done. If a major disaster happens, you know, God forbid, a tornado hits, and he can sit there and say, okay, Church Street closed between Maple Avenue and Graham Hopedale. Shelter number one open, and he never has to be at his computer. So that's what the possibility is for government.
So is that a step? Is that a step up over text message or something?
Yes,
like
it is.
That?
It's yes, quick. It is. Yes, it is.
I just learned how to transfer pictures yesterday on my cell phone. Okay, thank you, Scott. Yes,
thank you, Scott.
Good job, Scott. Good job.
Okay, next we'll. Yeah. Next, we go to the interim county manager reports. Do you have any?
Madam Chair, a couple items. First, I need to get some clarification. Was it the board's desire for staff to contact the Department of Revenue to have them come in and do an analysis of the tax department and the?
Yeah, I think so.
I think it was consensus.
Is that concurrent here? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So based on what Mr. Connolly presented to y'all as yes. to what the Department of Revenue could do, we'll approach that.
Okay.
Second thing is, Clyde needs a clarification on the. Resolution dealing with the Board of ENR from our last meeting. He has to ask a question about that.
Do you want to go ahead and approve that resolution? Point the Board of Equalization to review.
Yeah, I mean, do we?
I think we might want to look at this. I mean, this is a serious issue we got coming up.
Do we have anybody else that wants to be on that board?
Well, I've had several calls.
I think there are.
We plan to approve that because we need to go ahead and get that set up.
Okay, well, we can do it. I just want to know if we got anybody that wants to be on it. Did we?
Yeah.
Did we put that out? Have we put that out at all?
No, I don't know.
How can we put that out? That
I mean, you had five that were on there last year.
Yeah, and Kim was going to address that issue in a minute. I was thinking that what the question you had, Clyde, though, was as how you wanted the resolution establishing the Board of ENR, how you wanted that to read. Is that
we have the form we presented to you, and I had suggested that the. A second level of review be set up. I don't know if that's your pleasure or not.
And
the commissioners being the
second. We're going to put in terms on that. Was that what was that?
Well,
on there?
The Board of Equalization review has a limited life anyway.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. After July, it's done with the review.
I think maybe we can put it on the next agenda
and publicize it.
And just any. Commissioners that have any ideas, anybody they'd like to recommend, bring them at that time.
I think, doesn't the statute give that opportunity to commissioners to appoint
yes.
one from each commissioner?
Yes, yes,
and
it does.
I thought I read that somewhere.
Yeah.
Is there any form that they have to fill out, Clyde? Do you know?
Yeah.
You just present a name.
Appoint, you present it for the rest of the commissioners to vote on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Madam Chair, that was kind of the other issue. Kim may be able to address this, but at the last meeting there was some discussion, but no firm direction whether you want to advertise those positions, whether you want to bring, we didn't discuss this at that time, but whether you want to bring back your own nominations or how you kind of wanted to handle, and then the appointments would be made at the next meeting, which would be the April 6th meeting. I think that's kind of
Now, Kim may want to further elaborate on that, but I think that's kind of what we were trying to get some direction along those lines.
That is correct. We do have five existing members that served last year that have expressed their willingness to serve again. But if it be the board's desire, we can advertise the position and see who we have who's interested in the board, or the board members may have their own people in mind.
Okay.
Thank you.
So can we just bring that up at the next meeting?
I think at the next meeting, the appointments would need to be made. Is that correct?
All right. Based we need to prepare the decision, board for beginning meeting the 1st of May. So if we could, if the board would like for us to advertise, if we could go ahead and advertise and then possibly get you.
So is that a consensus to advertise it then?
Yeah.
I think we need to.
I think you're going to see some advertising right here in front of me. Right.
Yeah.
That's a good thing.
We would like for you to advertise that.
Yeah.
Okay. Bob, will you include it?
Okay. For a fee, right?
All right.
For free.
Do you have anything else?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. All right. We'll go to the consent agenda. Has anybody got any questions on that? Okay. I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
Is that a motion?
Okay.
Say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we approve the consent agenda. We got the commissioner's comments. I think at this point we want to let Kim speak, and we have some questions for her. Instead of going into the executive session, I think that we can probably ask the rest of our questions in the public. So if we could just we have some questions here that. I think we got one of them answered that we thought was going to ask in the closed session. And I think we may can just do all these. And if you don't mind, I will start with one of them about changing the programs. Kim, can you elaborate more on that as to why you changed programs in the middle of this revaluation? And
changed the software.
It changed the software. And did you feel that that had an impact on what's going on?
Our primary reason for changing software had to do with collections. We had a real struggle in collections and doing garnishments and other enforced collection procedures with the old software. It was at the recommendation of the County Commissioners Association when they came into our office and did a task force study that we abandon the software that we had for collections. We were able to go with a company who gave us a one package deal. They were already in Alamance County in the Social Services Department, so we were able to go with this company, and long story short, that's why we made the decision to change the software company. Anytime you change software and you're converting data over and over again, then there are chances for errors or data maybe to be brought over incorrectly. So to answer your question, it's possible that some of the conversions, some of the value problems that we're experiencing had to do with conversions, but you know, we tried to put measures in place to catch those, but we weren't able to catch every instance. So yes, ma'am, it could be.
I'll start with Eddie. Do you have another
I've got one question. I know the last meeting we were talking about the elderly. Are we doing anything helping them to work through this informal process? Have you done anything trying to work with the elder care or any of the groups trying to get the information how they can appeal, say they can't get to down here to the tax office?
Well, yes, sir. I have had the opportunity to speak to a couple of groups, and I go to speak whenever I'm invited to offer suggestions about our tax relief programs that will help our senior citizens, and also to talk about the valuation process. And yes, just today I had a call where an individual wanted us to come to do a home inspection for her elderly mother who was bedridden, who couldn't get out. So, yes, sir.
Okay. So what groups are you addressing with this information?
Well, I spoke to AARP.
AARP.
Yeah, Bailey Knutterson, exactly. About a month ago, and then I was out in Glen Raven community last week on Tuesday night following the Board of Commissioners meeting, and we spoke to a group about the revaluation and then also some of the tax relief programs. So those are the two most recent.
Okay, I think it's important that we do that because
yes, sir.
There's a lot of people across our county that don't have the means to get here, and we need to do all we can to work with.
Yes, sir.
And same, does your staff know that you have told people that we can send somebody to their house? Because my email says different right here, that they had called and was told no way that anybody would come out to their house.
Well, I think what's happened is maybe some little miscommunication. Now, you know, I've got some 8 people answering the phone, and then I've got 6 appraisal staff. And the informal review process is normally no, you know, we don't come out to do a site inspection of the property. But I think if it's clarified in this particular instance that I had today,
which may be this one,
which may be that one, the clerk got to a point and, you know, told the taxpayer that no, we wouldn't be able to come out. But then when they transferred it to me, after talking about the situation, then we determined that it would be necessary to go out.
I just want to make sure that all of them know that we do have the means to go out.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, Dean.
What specific criteria was used to come up with the schedules of values? What did you use here in Alamance County to do that?
Well, we looked at building costs, what it would cost to construct a house, a home. We actually visited different businesses, you know, Lowe's, Home Depot, some businesses around that install septic fields, and asked them, you know, what does it cost to put in, you know, a septic field? And you can find some of those businesses in the schedule values. So we actually went out to the market to see what it costs to build a house, a deck, a porch, you know, an outbuilding, and considered even labor factors. What did it cost for a brick mason or a framer or a roofer?
Where would you get that information? Did you go out to the different contractors, or how did you obtain that information?
We went out to the businesses and obtained the information, and then as far as the labor rates, we went to the Employment Security Commission to get the labor rates for our county.
Other counties' information? Did you incorporate information from other counties in any way to come up with that formula that you use?
Labor factors or something
No.
We actually went to the labor market, to the Employment Security Commission, and got the ones for Alamance County. No, sir.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Kim?
How did you assign the, you've got 60-some thousand pieces property here.
Yes, sir.
You've got X amount of appraisers, right?
Yes, sir.
How did you assign who got what?
I don't know that there was necessarily an assignment. It was,
I mean, how'd they get it?
Well, what we did was we divided the county up into neighborhoods, some 680 neighborhoods, and then we worked those neighborhoods as they came up. We actually started in Graham and Burlington and worked our way out, and then went to the rural part.
So
of
all
the
appraisers theoretically could have been in the same division.
Could have been in the same township. Mm-hmm. You know, in Burlington, I think there was close to 80 neighborhoods. So with 6 appraisers, yeah, you could have a number of appraisers within that one township.
How can you explain, Linda? Ms. Massey brought up a beautiful example. You know, condos mm-hmm. side by side. How much difference between the two?
Well, one went down $25,000. He's coming down here to appeal it and wants hers brought back up again.
But it's in the same complex,
it's
right?
It's on Huntington Road, right in the same scenario.
Mm-hmm.
Same number of bedrooms.
Three, yeah.
How can you explain that?
Well, I would like to know what properties they are so I can explain it, so I know exactly what happened. You know, without knowing what the properties are.
I can give you both their names.
Well, that would,
I will not do
well,
it.
Yeah.
I won't do
in
it
theory,
up here.
It's the same building or same
complex. Floor plan and everything.
I mean, I don't even see how it could be possible.
But what I hear from Ms. Massey is that the values went up, or the value changed from 01. One went up by $25,000
or more. I don't know. They were asking me And they were talking among themselves too, you know, and one of them said, well, I'm going to appeal mine. And said, I'm going to appeal mine too, but I want it.
So if we're talking about the value changing from one reval to the other reval, it's possible that the old value had started $25,000 difference. The difference may have been at the old revaluation.
I will look at it tonight. I have not looked. I can look at it myself.
Yeah, I mean, if you email me their names, I will be glad to research it and then provide all the board members with what my findings are.
What have you, what's the total evaluations so far? Have you come to a figure
to
on
the
that?
The appeals?
No, on the property, the new evaluation.
The real estate base?
Yeah.
Before, I gave this report last week, but before exemptions, I think it's like $11 billion. Was that the amount?
That sounds about right.
Somewhere around $11
billion. And we're at what? Now?
11.
I mean, before the reevaluation.
It was 9?
10.
Close to 10. 9.6, mm-hmm. I think.
Okay. Have you come to a figure of revenue neutral yet? Have you?
15.
Well, I'll let management or finance that's working on the budget address the revenue.
They may not know yet.
Have a tentative number. There's actually the local government commission has a spreadsheet online that you actually enter your data in, and it will give you what's revenue neutral. We've got a tentative amount, but there, as they still refine their numbers based on the appeals, that is subject to change. So what we have right now would probably not be good to rely on that at this point until we have some final numbers based on their appeals.
Okay.
Let me talk to them.
Okay. Kim, I tried to search out RSM appraisals, and I couldn't find them anywhere. Is this a company, or is it an individual? No, when did they become a company?
They're incorporated, and actually, I can give you a little bit of history. The president of the company actually worked in Alamance County in 1976, 1977, on the revaluation.
Mr. McCarthy.
With Cole Lael, CLT Trumbull, who did Alamance appraisals then in 77. He worked for that company then. He was also hired by my predecessor, Steve Kreisel, in around 2002 to come in and do some work in Alamance County with new construction. But he's been around several counties. He helped assisted Rockingham County with their commercial properties. He worked in Durham County. I know he did work in Chatham County. He's worked in Gaston County, Lincoln County, Alexander County. And I have a list of references of the counties that he worked in.
I think you had it listed on that sheet. When did he become incorporated?
That I can't. I don't know that answer. I'll be glad to research that for you, but I don't know that answer.
Well, I tried on the computer, and I didn't get anywhere. What about this Mr. Campbell? Do you know him personally?
Well, Mr. Campbell is a project consultant that was brought in with RSM appraisal at the beginning of our project. So that was my first introduction to Mr. Campbell.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Did your folks visually go out and check each parcel?
Yes, ma'am. There was two inspections done of the property. Of course, if there was a gate that prohibited us access to the property, we weren't able to access it. And then our rural vacant land that's inaccessible, no, we did not walk all those properties. But as far as residential and commercial buildings, we visited them one time to verify a listing and our data was correct. Yes, ma'am. And then a second time we did what people refer to as a drive-by. But that was just where we rode by the property one more time to compare our value to what we were actually seeing in the field.
I thought I remembered in 2006 when you first started talking about reval that they would go onto the property, they would measure, they would do this, walk it off, whatever, and come up with some decisions. And I'm kind of questioning whether that was actually done.
Actually, that was put in place before I got here in 2006, where the appraisers went out and verified the listing of the property. And yes, they did go out and pull measurements on the homes. Yes, ma'am.
I've got one more question here. I got an email today on this, and the guy was asking me, he said he had actually set up an informal meeting to come in and talk with him. His wife, she had called trying to schedule a meeting to come and talk to you about her some inherited property. He was told he could come for his meeting. She was told she couldn't. It was recommended that she just fill out the bottom of the tax form and send it back. And I guess my big question here is, are we being consistent in everything we're doing? And if not, what are we going to do to correct that?
Well, again, you know, there's two options available. You can fill out the form, mail it in, or you can schedule an appointment. And as far as I know, that's what my staff is being
told.
Have
we had a team meeting on that as far as
staff? We had a team meeting, and Amy actually attended the meeting. Okay. So, you know,
I just want to make sure for
we opened the
citizens,
meeting up for
equally.
Other departments in the building that were affected by the.
No, I don't want that. I got it.
Yeah, I actually talked to Terry this afternoon, probably after you did. And
I think we all got it.
Yeah, he has a meeting set up now. He had called back.
But Sherry could not get a meeting. Yeah. That was the question mark. Yeah, he was treated. Yeah. She was treated different than he was treated. And just want to make sure that everybody downstairs knows what to tell people, because somebody told her that just she had to fill out the form and not to come in.
Well, again, if I had a name of a clerk, I would be glad to follow up on that with you. So if you want to forward that to me later.
I can investigate it.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I got two things here. First of all, you know what we have said we want you to do. And how do you feel about implementing that at this point? That you will let this be done on the spot like you did Eddie's, like you did the man's in the paper, like a fireman that got his reduced $30,000 and said that if he got a paper that had not been done, to please come back. But he was told on the spot that his property would be reduced by $30,000. Now, if we don't do that, you're going to spend for 10 to 12,000 people sending out a mailing, and then they got to go through, and that's going to cost right much money.
Well, we actually have to go through the mailing process. That's a mandated by the statute.
But some of them will say, yes, we're going to reduce yours, and they can tell you that on the spot, because you've got to be fair with everybody, Kim. I'm sorry.
Yes,
if
ma'am.
If some of your people can do it, why can't all of them do it?
And they can.
Well, I was told you told them not to do it. Do not tell anybody that you're going to lower their taxes.
Well, what I suggested, and I actually have this in a handout that was given to them, if it's to correct a clerical error or something that's obviously wrong with the property, it's okay to fix that. But if it's something in which you feel that you really owe that taxpayer because they took their time to get all this information together, and in that 20-minute interview, I mean, they've spent days of looking for comps or appraisals, that it's only fair that we consider what they tell us. And in order to consider it, we may need to go back out to that property and look at it again.
And they can tell us that.
And then they
because
can.
I clearly took a house I have listed and showed him what I had. Showed him, here's what I got it listed for. Here's what you're saying it's worth. There's no way that house is going to sell for what it's worth. But I didn't get mine fixed, but I didn't ask to get it fixed. But there's something that I think when these people bring in comps, Greenway Park is another example, and I've already done 17. Mm-hmm. All right. Greenway Park, there is no way in the world that the houses that I've looked at over there are going to sell for what we have them appraised for. Okay. Because Greenway Park has just gone down. And one house over there sold for $35,000. It was a HUD. It was in foreclosure. I understand all that. But it still affects the comps, regardless, as far as real estate goes. So I think that we need to fix this thing downstairs. If they can tell these people, yes, we can do something about it, they need to do that.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and I think all the commissioners feel the same way.
And I think that in order for the appraisers to do that accurately, that they, you know, need to take the time to enter it into the system, because, you know, when you do the math on paper,
when it goes into a computer, it may not come out exactly the right. So I will make sure that appraisal staff does realize the board's wishes. Yes, ma'am. It's not a problem.
Okay. And I think that might help alleviate some of this animosity that we have felt. And the 200 phone calls or more that I have gotten. I mean, I stay on the phone. I need a headset. I went over my minutes on my cell phone and...
And emails.
Yeah. I emailed somebody the other night at 1:30 in the morning, and it was about the a lake that this woman wanted to go to, and it was 1:30, and I emailed her, and Brian knows about that one, and she's like, the next morning she said, you need to go to bed, it's 1:30. So, but, I mean, I try and answer all of them, and I don't, you know, it's just taking up my whole days, and I'm proud to be a county commissioner, and I want to be what's fair. I want to do what's fair, and I want everybody here, because I don't want everybody talking about you, Kim. Because I don't want everybody talking about me, so, or this board, or anybody else here. So that's why I want everything to, you know, we need to work the best way we can for the citizens.
But we still have to send out those notices in
that. That's fine.
But, you know, we will accommodate, and I'll make sure staff knows that.
Okay. Okay. All right, let's see what I got to do now. Are there any announcements?
Thank you, Kim.
Thanks.
I want to bring up something here, because we've got some people here tonight that I'm sure are possibly interested in this, and I want to make it brief too. I think it's time we all go, but I do want to hit on this. There are three bills in Raleigh. There is a Cleveland County representative that's introduced legislation, Gaston County representative that's introduced legislation, a senator from Catawba County. They're all, forgive me for being given a partisan report, but they're all Republicans. And they've introduced legislation in regards to the E-Verify program. And I understand that we are involved with E-Verify here. What's the status of us using E-Verify as a government agency?
I thought it was killed on the national level.
No, it hasn't been killed. It's snowballing.
We're using E-Verify for all new hires for Alamance County, and we have been for a couple of months at least.
Probably 6 months.
Yeah. It was in place before
I came. Is it done in your office?
Done in the Human Resources office. We haven't had any problems with it. We've right. not had any cases where we were concerned about the eligibility of someone to come to work for us.
What about people that do work for us? Like, we're getting ready to go in $10 million worth of contracts.
The contract employees are not handled through human resources. We only handle people that are paid directly through our payroll system.
Right. Why can't, what's the procedure for us, you know, implementing that at our level, county? I mean, I thought we were doing that.
Well, I guess we could do the purchasing department to the minority and members of us. I'll look at these bills and see what they're.
Well, let me give you the bill numbers. It's HB 344, HB 324, and Senate bill is 337. And there's another one that I haven't gotten. Kerry Allred has co-sponsored one of these. I think he's co-sponsored 324, which is supposedly a bill designed for anybody that's getting stimulus money, that they have to go through E-Verify to hire anybody. And that's supposedly what that one is. But there's another one where they're just trying to pass. Of course, it's going to be hung up in committee, and I don't think it's going to become a partisan issue. Because the only bills that the Democrats have submitted is one to keep you from being able to check immigration status if you enter a community college. They're trying to forbid that. That's being sponsored by Democrats. So there's a stark difference here of philosophy. But I'd like to see, you know, what we could do legally with the people that we hire, the people that, you know, if you have, for instance, the courthouse project over here. You know, I'd like to know what is possible that we could implement for who they hire and who their subcontractors hire and so forth. because it's all legal. Homeland Security endorses E-Verify 100%. It's not perfect, but it's better than nothing. I like to see it.
Clyde, they were talking earlier about House Bill 423, and that was one that Kerry Allred had also pushed in, but it's not going anywhere. If it is indeed just about raising the amount for seniors from $20,000 or $25,000 up to $30,000, personally, I think it should be higher than that. But if that be the case, could you come up with a resolution? I hate to give you anything else to do, but come up with a resolution for us to sign it as a board to send to Raleigh, because it's not being heard. Again, it's probably those Democrats up there that from Orange County that hello that are not allowing it to go into committee. And, you know, if we can do something to help, I think we should.
I'll be glad to get you a copy of all these bills and give you a resume of all, a summary of all of them, and we can explore them and see what we can do.
Sure. I hate to ask you, but
it won't take long.
Okay. Thank you.
Dan has one
real,
other
real
thing.
Real quick, the Value-Added Food Processing Facility is fully funded. And we'll be making some committee assignments in the near future, and I'll get with all of you on that. So we're good to go.
And in closing, I would like to thank Mr. Honeycutt for being here tonight. For any of you who have not met your new county manager, it's Mr. Craig Honeycutt, and please speak to him tonight if you hadn't met him. And thank you for coming.
Thank
Wally for coming.
Yeah, right. College.
Well, I forgot how to pronounce it. I was like, oh. Anyway, thank you for coming.
Mr. Wally.
And I'm sorry we stayed so long, but hopefully we got something settled tonight and worked on, and hopefully it will make things easier as soon as Bob Boyer and Thomas gets in the paper. And at that point, we are adjourned.
It might take a week. Hey, Bob, it might take a week.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioner's website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.